Welcome to Mic Drop, the podcast where relevancy is irrelevant and we don't give a shit about your feelings. Ladies and gentlemen, as always, it's both an honor and a pleasure to welcome my next guest to the podcast. He spent 5 years on active duty with the 82nd Airborne. He is the co-host of Drinking Brothers and American Party. And he is, in fact, the biggest piece of shit that you have never heard of, although yeah, I have sure. heard of you, Dan.
Well, yeah, you have.
Yeah. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the stage, Dan Holloway.
Nice to be here.
What's the best orgasm you've ever had?
The best one I've ever had? That's a good question. I think it's... can't remember the dude's name. No, it's...
Did he have good, strong
that's
hands?
A good question. That's actually a good question. I don't know how to answer that. What do you mean by best?
I mean, the one that when you were done, you like looked up and shook your head and like, God damn, what just happened?
Well, last night's wasn't bad,
yeah.
To be honest. Yeah, it's one of those ones where you like...
try to break the record every day.
Yeah, where you were talking about when you were sick, having to grab onto the bed and stabilize yourself because the room's spinning.
Yeah.
I get like that. It's like, oh Jesus Christ. Like, just don't touch me or look at me or say anything for 5 minutes.
Don't touch it. Don't touch it.
Yep.
What's the worst orgasm you've ever had?
The worst, it's like pizza, right? Even when it's bad, it's good. Yeah. I'm a dude. I don't think that's even a thing.
Yeah. Favorite restaurant?
Favorite restaurants. Lonesome Dove in Austin is really good. They have a lot of game meat. There's one in Nashville, too, if you're ever out there.
They have gay meat. What is gay meat?
Game.
Oh, like, game, yeah.
I mean, some of them are probably gay. I don't know. I don't know what percentage. I think like 5% of the human population is some kind of gay, so you got to expect it.
I thought it was more like 11.
Look, how many people have told you they have celiac disease? It's actually 1.5% of the population, right?
Yeah.
I think some people just dabble.
Like 90%. what's your biggest regret?
I don't do that.
Yeah.
Regrets are fucking pointless.
Yeah, I agree.
I mean, what are you going to do with that? That's like present tense worry about a past tense event. That doesn't make any sense to me.
How about, let me phrase it this way then. If there was a decision that you made that you could get back, is there any of those?
Oh, well, I'm sure there are plenty, right? But
not picking winning lottery numbers.
That's kind of what life is, right? You don't want to go back and second guess all that stuff. You want to build. It's a foundation.
Yeah. I'm going to ask a third way to try to get something out of you.
Good luck. You might need surgery to get something out of me.
If there's something that you've done that you could have done better.
Yeah, that's a good question. I mean, look, I think the main regret that, there's survivor's guilt that a lot of us deal with, but I think the main actual, if you want to call it a regret or something that we might change is, realizing sooner that turning my pain into empathy for other people in my same situation can save, this is a quote of mine, if you turn your pain into empathy for others, you can save 2 lives, theirs and yours, right? So understanding that it wasn't just me feeling that way and that the process of helping other people is the best way to come to terms with your own grief.
Yeah.
I think realizing that earlier in life probably would have been a great benefit to me and to other people as well.
Would you say that that's something that that you struggled with pretty hard for a while before you came to that conclusion?
I mean, I think it's, and it's not just unique to people that have been in combat or even traumatic experiences in general. It's just life. Like in the workplace, things aren't going well, morale's bad, and the presumption from everybody is that I'm doing all the work and nobody else is doing shit. But everybody feels that way, but everybody's still working hard. This is typically what it is a vacuum of leadership. There's no leadership there to remind people that they're doing well or to make sure everybody's focused on the same task. And I think in the case of our experiences, it's kind of the same. We have a hard time asking for help, even from each other, which is stupid because if you or I are stacked up and I need to change mags or something, or I need a mag, it wouldn't even be an issue to ask you for that. Or hey, I need you to fucking cover this, or I'm hit, fucking fix my leg or whatever. Wouldn't even be a second thought. But if it's like, hey, I'm having some stupid thoughts that I know don't make sense, but they're fucking with me.
Yeah.
Can we go out and get a beer is a problem for us for some reason. Yeah. I don't know why.
I think ego ultimately is that I think most guys, especially AA, you know, personality guys, whether it's consciously or subconsciously, think of that as weakness.
Right.
You know,
which is
dumb. But I think that's really the root cause of that is that, it's like, because if you use that example of, covering your six or, hey, I need fucking ammo or whatever, is it that like, that's an environment that you train for that you, it's offensive, it's fucking aggressive, whereas this is not that, and I do think, to the not training for it point, they could do a lot better job about, incorporating that into, the culture or mentality of warfighters of bringing that component to just to day-to-day life. But I think that's the biggest thing is that it's if something hurts, right, it's fucking suck it up.
Right, yeah.
You know, it's like, oh, it's painful to hang on the pull-up bar. Fucking keep hanging there, you cunt.
Yeah.
So this is kind of that same thing. It's like, hey, I'm hurting. And so, I think just the traditional answer is if it's uncomfortable or if it hurts, then you shut the fuck up and you deal with it, because it's that way with everything else. And so I think that's our community's biggest, I think that's human beings' biggest problem with that, but especially our community. But I know for me, in that same vein, like something I wish I would have came to the conclusion sooner of is the way that I kind of reconcile that is putting myself in whoever is not their shoes. And if they were, if they have the ability, whatever the fuck happens after you die, and they saw me doing what I'm doing, like if that was me, I'd reach through the afterworld and slap the fuck out of you and be like,
yeah,
hey,
exactly, yeah.
You have an opportunity, stop fucking blowing it.
Yeah, I think that's a good way to live your life. I mean, Dakota Meyer and I on American Party podcast came up with this list of principles that we think kind of outlines what it means to be an American, like what you should do, some like affirmative phrases, not like, the secret or whatever, like trying to wish shit into existence.
I'm good enough. I'm smart enough. God damn it. People like me.
Yeah. That dude got me too as well.
I know it.
One of them though is, there's a lot of basic stuff like I'll support and defend the Constitution and all that. One of them is I'll live a life worth dying for. And I think it's an important thing to remember in America. We have won the lottery, so to speak, just by being born here.
Yeah.
But it's that is a victory that has to be fought, maintained.
Yeah.
And I think it dishonors the memory of people to sit around and wallow in your own suffering and grief.
Agree.
You know what I mean? So yeah. I certainly wouldn't want that if I were the one that was dead.
Yeah.
I wouldn't want people to be sitting around thinking about me. Although I think kids these days might want that.
Yeah. You never know.
There's a lot of social currency involved in
victimhood.
Being oppressed or victimhood or whatever the fuck.
Yeah, we'll get into the ins and outs of that here in a little bit. But I know you're going to answer this one quick with probably one of these two. So I'm going to say, without it being California or New York, what's the worst state in America?
That's a good question.
Shittiest state you've ever been?
The shittiest state I've ever been. Damn. That's a good one.
There's a lot of them.
You took out all the fucking good answers. I think Oregon probably or Washington right now. Yeah. Actually, you know what? I would say probably Washington, not just because of Seattle, but because the speed limit on the freeway is like 55 up there and everybody drives 50 and it drives me nuts. What
you
the hell?
Driver?
Just because it's raining? Cars are designed to drive through this shit. Just get the fuck out of the way.
Do you typically drive fast as fuck?
Not really. Yeah. I just want people to get the fuck out of the way. Like you drive, it's part of the social contract in driving. We go about 5 to 7 miles per hour over the speed limit and you stay on the right unless you're passing somebody. That seems like a pretty easy rule to follow.
Yeah.
And it's also an easy rule to follow when you're walking. I want us to maybe think about a constitutional amendment that requires people to treat walking, especially in airports, the same as they treat driving. Stay on the right side and get the fuck out of the way if people are faster behind you. It seems like a reasonable thing.
Yeah, and stay off your phone while you're doing it.
Yeah, Jesus Christ.
I'd like to take a quick second to shout out and thank our sponsor for today's podcast, Origin Labs and Jocko Fuel. Jocko Fuel is a great product. He's got a ton of products, actually, within the Jocko Fuel line. The guests and I enjoy them on the show.
And outside, I take a lot of the supplements. I've got some of the Origin Lab jeans, boots, geese, and it's just all around American industry. They do a fantastic job really re-revolutionizing American industry from start to finish. It's all American made, all American sourced. Everything start to finish is made right there in-house, and they really do a phenomenal job creating the products and fulfilling the whole ball of wax. They've been a huge supporter of the Mic Drop podcast for a while now, and I really can't thank Jocko Fuel and Origin Labs enough for the job that they do for us. And so thank you to you guys.
I'd also like to talk about my brand of dog food that just came out.
What are the two key components for canine success? That's effective training and proper nutrition. Fueled by Team Dog brings those two components to your family and best friend. The perfect nutritional balance that results in a higher mental acuity, energy, overall vitality, and even an improved appearance. Every product you will find in my company's store was born from the battlefield and not from the boardroom. Let my life's work help you become your dog's hero.
Yeah, amen. What is your morning routine on a normal morning where you're in town?
Yeah, I usually I wake up around 7:30 or so, not too early anymore. The first thing I do is let my dogs outside.
Yeah.
And watch them wrestle for a while, which is hilarious. And I usually drink some coffee and eat something and then sit around. I check emails and read the news and stuff for a couple of hours because I do the shows, and the earliest one ever starts is noon. So
yeah,
it's not like I got to be in the office early or anything like that, but people don't realize how much goes into all this stuff.
Yeah.
Oh, you just talk for a couple of hours and go home. Like, no, it's a little more complicated than that. I mean, we own and run the business ourselves like you do. So it's a pain in the ass.
Yeah.
And the process of, like, I'm the person on these shows that's very well informed about things, so that takes a lot of effort. I would say I probably spend, unless it's just some random show where we're talking about bullshit, I spend 2.5 or so hours researching before any 1 hour long show.
Yeah.
Something like that. So I like doing it in the morning just to get prepared for the day and stuff like that, and it gets my brain moving and stuff.
Do you eat in the morning?
Sometimes. I mean, I forget to eat a lot,
yeah,
to be honest. Like, I'm not very food driven. I'm like a dog in that way, or like a shitty dog in that way. I eat a lot. I mean, I use the Traeger quite a bit.
Yeah.
But it's, I don't know. I've been thinking about doing on the diet thing. I've been thinking about, cause we had Brett Weinstein and his wife Heather Hing on the show on American Party not too long ago. I'm not sure if you're familiar with them.
Mm-hmm. Vaguely, but yeah.
They're both like evolutionary biologists, right? Very smart people on how the human body works and how it's come to be the way it is and stuff like that. And they're really big proponents of the, I don't know what it's called, maybe the hereditary diet, like eat like your ancestors did. So I'm kind of looking into that now. And I also, my understanding is from all the latest science that intermittent fasting is probably the best way you can use to train your body.
Yeah, trust the science, Dan.
Yeah. Trust the scientist, I think is what they're saying. Yeah. Speaking of that, Fauci got caught. Finally, I mean, at what point is the smoking gun? When the NIH deputy director says, hey, yeah, we totally did that. Is that enough or is it something else?
I mean, to me, like politics, and this fucking both sides are guilty because there's things that Trump did, the same thing that right wingers like just, you know, turn a fucking blind eye to. And I think that's one of the biggest problems. I talk about this in the new book where, like, you have got to hold yourself and your own side, whatever fucking party side entity that is, to the same goddamn standard that you hold the other side to. Because if you don't, then none of it matters.
Yeah, I would say that's your first responsibility.
Yeah, but that's not what happens.
I mean, don't we say, like, take the timber out of your eye before you take this, whatever the fuck the Bible. I've actually got a degree in comparative religion, but I'm not religious. But
yeah,
I think the better quote is mind your business,
yeah,
or mind make your sure your house business. Is in order before, yeah, you start going and cleaning everybody else's up.
Yeah.
I mean, you don't really have a whole lot of firm footing to stand on to criticize somebody else when you don't even know what the fuck's going on your own side.
Yeah. Or if you're not willing to at least hold yourself and, right, and that side to the same fucking standard. And that's,
there's
got to
be a process, though, right, for being wrong and then becoming right, and then that's it.
Yeah.
Like, you're right now, because that's how every single human being has learned everything forever.
Yeah.
You didn't know something. Somebody taught you that. and then you tested on your own and confirmed it, or maybe you developed that idea a little bit more and made it better and discussed it among people. You were wrong at some point about everything, and now there's no appetite for that. If you're wrong about something in one of these ways, or you're not on the right side of history or something like that, at some point people just want to fucking move that goalpost over to the other side and cancel your ass. It doesn't make any sense to me.
No, I agree. And the irritating thing for me on it is that if you look at it from any other component of our society, like I can't think of anything else that's that way, like where there's a spin to everything.
Yeah.
Like think about sports. It's like, you know, yeah, I know you caught that pass, but you really didn't. You know?
Like,
I mean, that's kind of what it is. It's like, I know you think you saw what you're looking at, or I think you think you see that, but that's actually not what's happening.
Not a lot of people talking about privilege in sports, are they?
Yeah. Like, well, yeah, I mean, we were talking about this on one of the other shows, is that, you know, to me that's one of those things. It's like when any group of people complains about another group of people holding them down, or on behalf of anybody else. I mean, to me, if you think about it from the prospect of again, we'll take sports. It's like you play against a team in soccer, mm-hmm. right? And you guys shoot fucking 300 times and the goalie stops you every time. And then the post interview, what happened? He wouldn't let us fucking score.
Yeah.
You know, that goalie kept us from fucking scoring this whole time.
I mean, ultimately it's what in this, when you're talking about different groups succeeding in society, you're talking about basically a cultural insurgency, right?
Yeah.
So your idea is to gain patronage. I mean, it's the classic steps of insurgency. One is establish a presence. Two is gain patronage and blah, blah, blah. You don't do that by standing in the street pissing people off. You know what I mean? You make friends with people.
Yeah.
And I say this to folks all the time. I was talking to, Wednesday of this week, we had a very liberal dude, but he also understands math, and we agree that the only color that really matters in this country is green, right? So that the idea that one side has tried to solve the issue of inequality by giving handouts and providing no upward mobility, it's like you want them to be a little more comfortable, but not so much that they don't need you anymore. And I can't think of anything more evil than that, frankly.
Yeah. I mean, like if you want to talk about oppression, like that's textbook.
Yeah.
You know, it's pulling the fucking strings and making one group of people feel like they're dependent on you for their success.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, so like, and again, like when I see any group of people in any context, and I'm sure people will listen to my analogy and say, well, it's not that simple, or that's racist for even fucking, you know, saying something like that, because it would be akin to tying their fucking shoestrings together and then telling them to try to score or whatever. But the fact is that at this point in our society, in our chronological timeline, there are too many fucking examples of people either born here with nothing or even coming here with even less that have made, you know, themselves into multimillionaires or billionaires, business owners, super successful people.
Somebody made that point. I think it was, I can't remember who it was. It was a liberal person, actually. LeBron James was whining about something, and like the commenter was like, "You're talking about how evil this country that allowed you to become a billionaire is."
Yeah, by playing a game.
You know what I mean? Like, come on, man.
Yeah.
Well, I don't know. I think that I'm not really a fan of either one of these political parties. I think politicians are all a bunch of cunts, to be honest.
Well, I agree. Well, and you're shirt. I mean, we talked about that on your show, you know, the other day. Like, how do you defund politics legitimately? Like, it's a great catchphrase, but I mean, to me, that's the only way I can think of how you do that is you elect people based on the populace's opinion of who should be in office, not who's, you know, arrogant enough to fucking run for it. But
yeah, Rogan said something the other day, like, you want to look into my bank account and spy on me and see everything I do. And you think you've got the power to do that because you won a popularity contest.
Yeah.
Like, fuck you, dude.
Yeah. Well, that, you know, the other thing with that, too, is that, like, that's such a one way and one-sided fucking deal, too.
Yeah.
It's like, we can't keep our budget, You know, we can't spend money within our fucking confines. You don't get to know what the fuck we spend our money on. You don't get to know, you know, which one of us fucking gets insider information on all these top 10 fucking companies, you know, specifically medical ones, while we're pushing a vaccine down your throat. But, you know, if you're moving $600 around, like, who the fuck falls outside of $600 a year? Nobody. Well,
the new proposal that I've heard that's being circulated by the Democrats is they're going to up it to $10,000. Yeah. It won't include any income.
Yeah.
So that doesn't count. I don't know how the fuck they still have to go in there and look at that to figure it out in the first place.
Yeah. I mean, how are you monitoring bank accounts that are, they're moving more than $10,000?
And it's easy. A good law is clear, concise, and enforceable, right? Those are the three keys of a good law. And all you have to do to bypass that is set up an LLC that manages your fund, and you get paid as a consultant to your LLC, and all your capital gains go through that, and then you get paid a salary on it. Yeah. It's literally that easy to fucking bypass that. So that's nonsense. I say this shit all the time. So these money grabbing fucking lefties, they don't give a shit about poor people. They just hate rich people. Yeah. That's all it is.
Yeah.
And
which they fall into that category.
Yeah, they do. All of them do. The other thing about, I mean, what you're discussing is the social contract, right? And the hallmark, the key element of a contract is mutual consent. If you and I go into a business contract right now, we both put our names, we sign our names at the bottom of that to say we agree with all this shit. Now, the operating agreement for America is the fucking Constitution.
Yeah,
that we have all this superfluous shit now in the form of regular, like right now, this nonsense going on where people are losing their jobs because they don't want to the government involved in their personal medical decisions. It's not a law, it's a regulation. That's a big problem. Nobody voted on this stuff.
Yeah.
Nobody, this wasn't part of, as a matter of fact, when he was running for office, Biden said that we shouldn't mandate this stuff.
Yeah.
Right.
And now he's doing it.
I don't know what to tell you on this guy. He's out to lunch though. Did you see the town hall last night on CNN? He's just like standing here with his,
no, but
like a G.I. Joe or some shit.
Yeah. I mean, at this point, I try not to watch him as much as I can, because it's just, when I watch him, I mean, not only is it frustrating, but to me, it's like watching a horror film. You know, I'm just like, holy fuck, this guy's at the wheel. I mean, he's not, but still, like, he's the hood ornament on this busted fucking vehicle that is America right now. And I just, you know, I'm baffled between the election results being like, you know, him and Kamala were basically the two worst fucking in their field, and they somehow get the nod, and then somehow
people forget about that. He was done before South Carolina. He was out. And then he said, if you don't vote for me, if you're black and you don't vote for me, you're not really black. And he went to South Carolina, where a large portion of the Democratic Party is controlled by their black community, and he won that handedly. That doesn't make sense to me.
Well, so there was a comment by a senator, and I don't recall his name.
It was Scott, maybe?
No.
From South Carolina?
No, it was a Democratic senator or high-level politician. But he basically gave him a fucking mulligan on it.
Oh, yeah?
And said, you know, no, it's not a big deal, and he's my top fucking choice. And then from that point on, he just fucking ran the table with it, you know, and then managed to get, you know, 10 million more votes than the most popular fucking president in history. I'm not one of those guys that's saying, you know, hey, let's look at all this different shit, Michigan, Arizona, whatever, or I'm not saying that there's enough proof for me to say unequivocally that there was some shit going on, but there's enough to where I think it ought to be looked at more than just, no, that, you know, it's final, deal with it, you know.
Yeah, for like, sure. To me, the whole debate over what people would call the rigging or anything to do with any of these companies that control the ballot boxes and all that stuff, it just, I think it's unnecessary to have even done that. When you can control all of the news media, when you can control the primary platforms wherein people communicate with one another and get their news, social media platforms, control what people see, not only what they see, but how they see it, right?
Yeah.
And how often and things like that. You don't need to physically rig anything anymore. You are conducting a massive information operation campaign.
Yeah.
And that's obvious. I mean, that's not even this liberal dude, Alec Ross, I had on the show the other day, he's like, this isn't a conspiracy theory anymore. We have the proof that Facebook is doing this shit. We have the proof that Twitter is doing this shit now. So what the fuck, man?
Yeah. Well, and so the I think the tricky part with that is what do you do about that? You know, and trying to play devil's advocate, like, at the end of the day, it's a business, right?
Right.
It's a privately owned business. They can operate, or they should be able to operate it how they want. Now, the problem, I think, is that they've gotten so big, and this is where I do think the government's ability to control through antitrust laws makes sense in this case. You know, no different than, say, AT&T in the early 80s. Is that there has to be some kind of fucking balance that way. And I think, you know, we're at that point. But the problem is that the people that are in charge of the government that would have to give enough of a fuck, A, to do that, and then B, actually follow through with and enact that policy, are 100% on board with what they're doing and how they're doing it. So it's like, you know, the comment I made on your show the other day, like the fox fucking auditing himself in the hen house. Like, they're not going to do that because it's benefiting them. No different than Congress isn't going to decide that, you know, all of our taxes should be open loopholes and open to investigating us getting around through loopholes, or, you know, making sure that their taxes are available, mm-hmm. or putting a cap on how much money they can make privately. I mean, there's a lot of things that you could do that Congress could, you know, from a rule standpoint wise, give themselves to clear up a lot of the fucking mistrust that goes on, and they're never going to do it because they benefit. I mean,
well, they're certainly not going to do it. I mean, the number one stock owned by Congress is Apple.
Yeah, it's crazy,
right? Then Microsoft, then Bank of America, then Walt Disney, which owns ESPN, they
Sony,
own Fox now, or parts of it. They own
Sony too, right?
Yeah, they own Sony. They own ABC, all that stuff. Then AT&T, Pfizer, Johnson & Johnson. That's weird.
Yeah, strange.
Shit.
I wonder how that happened.
And ExxonMobil.
Yeah.
Good Lord, man. I mean, I think there should be probably some kind of, I mean, the Fed addressed it this week. They've banned Congress from investing in individual stocks now.
Yeah.
But come on, man.
Yeah, so now their spouse does it.
I mean, that's what Nancy Pelosi's husband has been doing for years.
Yeah, I mean, her as a good example, and McConnell or Lindsey Graham on the other side, same thing, is that, you know, any of those assholes that have been around 35, 40 plus fucking years at the top, you look at what they were worth when they came in, look what they're worth now, like that math does not add up. With one exception, is if there's some squirrely shit going on.
Yeah.
You know, there's no way around that. You can't make 170 grand a year for, I mean, at this point, like, they probably made, I'm sure it was south of six figures when they first came in. You know, so that the most you've ever made is maybe 200 grand a year and you're worth $40 million fucking dollars. Like, there's nobody else in America that can pull that off.
No, that's some gorilla math right there. And it's, I mean, these people are just, you're right. It's not just one side. I mean, I'm sure you've heard this analogy before, but for the audience, imagine there are red and like fire ants and black ants in a jar. Right, they will. This is actually a real experiment that's been done. They will operate irrespective of one another and more or less ignore each other. But if you shake the jar, then they assume the other one is doing it, and they attack and kill each other. But they never stop to think about who shook the jar.
Yeah,
and that is the perfect metaphor for American politics for me.
Yeah,
it's not about right or left. It's about right and wrong, and it's there, and this is nothing new either, by the way. This is an aristocracy. It's been happening forever. For as long as human civilization has existed, certain people have felt themselves above everyone else, and they've coordinated together to box out everybody else. For a long time, it was being born in the purple, like in the first century in Rome, for example. Like, your aristocracy. So you have the ability to run for office, become tribune, blah, blah, blah. If you're a pleb, no chance. And that's one of the reasons Julius Caesar got killed, because he started bringing plebs into the Senate from his Roman legions.
Well, and he was one.
Yes. Yeah, you know, he was one pleb. Yeah.
He was the first. I love that analogy. And that's, I think it kind of ties into or goes back to the privilege versus not thing, is that, you know, the wealthy people in this country are laughing, you know, while everybody's arguing over who has the fucking better deal or not or whatever. And the fact is that if you're of wealth, you have much more privilege than anybody else. But the kicker again is, how many people have come here from other countries, even illegally, you know, come here and now they're worth, you know, fucking $12 million and own several companies. Mm-hmm. you know, and started with fucking nothing. I mean, that tells you that if you give enough of a fuck, you know, and you work hard and smart, it's not just about working hard, or there'd be a lot of fucking rich people in this country, because there's a lot of people that work hard. But you know, the opportunity is absolutely there for everybody, you know, and anybody. I don't give a fuck who you are. I mean, you could take Hunter Biden, right? And you can say, you can hate the guy, which I, you know, is easy to do, but even with him, you can look at him and you can find somebody with a better fucking deal than that guy has. Right. Take a fucking Saudi prince. Like,
yeah, for sure. Anybody in the Saudi royal.
Yeah. You know, so, I mean, like you can always find somebody with a better deal than you. You can always find somebody with a worse deal. My problem and point is that when all you do is focus on that, is that now you're wasting all this bandwidth and resources and energy on something that isn't getting you where you want to go anyway. So focus on the shit that you can actually do something about.
Right. Yeah, I agree with that. I mean, that's the classic thing, though. It's a distraction, right? It's why the Roman Colosseum was built.
Yeah.
To let people watch slaves murder each other to distract them from the fact that their lives sucked, right? I'm a benevolent leader, and here is your entertainment.
Yeah.
And here's your free bread.
Are you not entertained?
Yeah. And that's essentially what it is. It's just it's magician's patter.
Yeah.
I say that because refer back to the first century, because this is nothing new.
Yeah.
Like they used it. They used those strategies back then. As you roll into the middle of the first millennia and then on through the medieval stage, primarily it was wardens controlling areas. So there were the diffusion of power was a little bit larger, but still pretty concentrated, and everybody else was just kept illiterate. So they didn't know any better. They couldn't write their own contracts, so they couldn't start a business. They couldn't appeal to the state for things. They just had to go to the king and beg him for shit. Right. And whenever he felt like saying, that's my deer, you can't hunt it, he could do that.
Yeah.
And, you know, after the Industrial Revolution, people, the printing press and stuff, people start reading like, oh, shit. People start seeing the thoughts of other smart people who are against the government, like William Shakespeare, for example, whose work was entirely subversive against the English government. They start reading this stuff and like, oh,
wait a minute.
They've been fucking us over for years.
Yeah.
And now instead of illiteracy, they use, you know, the us versus them stuff. They use whatever fucking fake, I don't know, fake emergencies maybe is a good word for it.
Or like a false flag attack.
The cause du jour, all this nonsense. And we fall for it pretty easily.
Yeah. And I think, like you said, it's akin to the shaking of the fucking jar full of ants. I am curious, where are you originally from?
South Carolina.
What was growing up for you like?
It was kind of shitty. I mean, I'm a pretty high functioning Asperger's guy, and I didn't really nobody knew what the fuck that was back then. So, it was a little uncomfortable, but not so much as it is for people that have worse afflictions. I'm actually pretty lucky in that regard. But my dad was a piece of shit. He was around at least though, which is, you know. There's something to be said for that, I guess. I mean, from my perspective, I'm more kind of a flat logic guy, so I don't let the emotion get involved too much in it. But he's not a great dude. Very abusive when I was a kid, but...
Is he still alive?
Yeah.
You still have a relationship with him?
No, no. No, I don't. I mean, it's not... for a long time when I was younger, I hated him, but now I don't even care.
Yeah.
It's like, what the fuck? Why am I wasting my time or attention or anything on somebody that means nothing to me? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But, you know... It was, it brings up this issue that I've been trying to solve and I can't figure out how to do it. And it's for kids these days. Like, I don't know how to simulate the hard times that make hard men. You know what I mean? Like, I don't know if it's even possible to do that.
I think it is. But, I think the problem is most people are lazy. It's easy to fuck up and... It requires a level of attention that is constant, you know, and most people get fucking tired of it. It's the exact same reason why most people's dogs aren't trained where the fuck.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, that's the reality is that, you know, most people are busy, you know, and again, this goes back to the opportunity. Like there's so much opportunity now, you know, between the internet and people starting their own businesses and e-commerce and, you know, or they work or whatever, inflation's up. So, you know, most families, you know, they're both their parents are working. And so you've got this super, you know, driven society in terms of trying to make it. and also trying to raise kids. And if you look at human history, you know, in the last, say, less than 100 years, we are now living from a family dynamic standpoint very, very unlike any other time in human history. You know, and so, I mean, when I was talking about the family dynamic being the biggest, I think, single point of failure in our society, I think that's why, is that when kids are really young in that first, you know, we'll say 10 years, where that foundation is really being laid, and when that window is closed, there's no going back, is that they're not learning the basic tenets of society that way. And so something...
Not just civics, but how...
Everything.
People who respect one another treat each other.
Yeah.
It's a big thing to learn.
Yeah, but even like helping out around the house, yeah. I mean, kind of to your point, the, you know, making times hard enough, I mean, like that has to be calculated.
Yeah.
You know, to manufacture it, it's no different than, say, any military training, right?
Yeah,
SEAL selection process, like, yeah. Is that, you know, most people see, you know, I'll take SEALs since that's my background, you know, Hell Week or BUDS in general, and they're like, they look at it and they're like, oh, these instructors are basically just walking around half-ass willy-nilly torturing dudes. Like, no, it like the science and strategy and calculation behind what they do, why they do it, when they do it, how long it goes on, all of that, what they do after, what they say before they do or don't do something, all that shit is intentional.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so to create, and that's what they're doing, right, is that they're manufacturing a peacetime environment that's as close as they can make it to combat stress, right, as possible, so that they can see if you're going to fucking crack or not. Mm-hmm. So it's doable.
Yeah, for sure.
But you got to really know what the fuck you're doing, and you have to do it all the time.
Yeah.
You know, and that's where, like, most people don't know how to do it. They either overdo it or they underdo it. They're either best friends with their kids or they kick the shit out of them. Mm-hmm. Like, there's no gray area. And so I think that's where you're at, is that, you know, if we're lucky enough to be able to consciously realize and understand that needs to happen, but we're not doing it, like, well, fuck, we deserve what we're getting then.
Yeah, we've definitely paid the full price for all the bullshit we're dealing with right now. There's no question about that. I mean, yeah. To your point, I always tell people that a little girl learns everything about how she should be treated by how her father treats her mother, and a little boy learns everything about how he should treat women in the same way,
yeah, like
how her father treats her mother. And that isn't to say that every couple needs to be fucking straight.
Leave it
with,
to Beaver.
With fucking 2.3 kids or whatever the aggregate bullshit is. But you need, and it's the same way in politics, you need a masculine and a feminine. The masculine provides and protects. That's the point of masculinity, is to provide and protect. And the fact that there's a wholesale onslaught against it in the media and in certain areas of politics, we are... effectively attacking the institutions that protect us. And then, yeah, you know, you need the feminine side as well to be empathetic and nurturing and shit like that. You need both. As a, yeah, human being, you need both.
Yeah.
Right. It just happens to be that evolutionarily over the last 500 million years, one gender skews to one side and the other to the other, but it doesn't have to be that way, but you do need both.
Yeah.
Right. Like, if you're a single mom out there, you better go find a fucking football coach or some dude that's a good man, that knows how to fucking talk to people, that knows how to teach subtly life lessons to the kid about what to do in situations when it's tough, when you have to sacrifice and shit like that. That stuff matters, right? So it doesn't matter who you love or who you fuck. I don't give a shit about that. But you better goddamn expose your children to the right shit.
Yeah.
Because that's the only chance you get.
Yeah.
Like, unbringing that bell once they're like 15, 16 years old, good luck with that shit.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, like I said, you know, there's a lot of parallels. And a lot of what I've learned with human beings over the years comes from a lot of interactions with dogs, because it's very black and white with them.
Yeah.
You know, we get muddled by speech, basically, is that...
Which is funny, because like 85% of all communication is nonverbal.
Yeah, well...
But the words we say,
yeah,
but fuck us up all the time.
Yeah, but so to me, here's one of our society's biggest problems, is that, yes, that's the case, and that's why I do all my shows in person.
Mm-hmm.
Is because it's very different. As you know, a lot of yours are via Zoom, which I get, you know, your volume is much higher than mine. But there's a huge component to that. But if you look at how we live now, just, and this is in the last 20 years, is that, you know, how much is body language and nonverbal communication, how much of a role does that play in Snapchat or text message, yeah, or exactly, email? Yeah. Zero.
Yeah.
You know, so you're removing, and we've talked about this, even my producer, who's a young kid, we've interacted with some other, you know, late teens, early 20s, you know, folks just in, you know, from a technology standpoint. And there seems to be like a recurring theme with a lot of them, not picking on you, Z, but yeah, I am.
You a little
know,
bit, yeah.
You know, I am picking on you. You're socially fucking retarded half the time is the problem. Is that, you know, they have an inability to pick up on social cues the way a human being is supposed to as an adult because they have very little experience doing so. And so it creates a huge fucking problem that
it's
way.
It's like social atrophy almost.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, that's essentially what it is. Yeah. It's.
Yeah. And the weird, you know, transverse and why I'm so hyper aware of it, I think, is it because with dogs, it's all that way. It's 100%. You know, like, yes, you know, they can learn commands that are coupled with behaviors. And, and yes, they bark or whine or growl, or, you know, there are certain verbal or auditory noises or cues that they may make or be a part of to communicate, but it's very, very little compared to body language, presence, intent, et cetera. So because that's kind of the world I live in, day out, I'm more aware of that, I think, probably than your average asshole. But it just, it really also highlights how inept the subsequent generations are becoming more and more that way as they grow up behind an iPad or a screen or
and we did it. We set them up for failure in that regard because it was just easier to hand them an iPad or it was just the convenience of technology that we enjoyed technology's convenience. And it seems like we've exposed them to it so much that they think that is just intrinsic value in life. And it's not. I mean, that's why people think that words are violence now, right? Because they've never seen real violence. Yeah. They've never been.
Because they haven't been punched in the fucking mouth.
You kick bullies off the playground just for words instead of actual. Yeah. Like an important lesson to learn in life is that to see a bully operating and being physical with somebody else, and then watching who in the group stands up and says something about it, right? Because that's how leaders are developed. And I worry about our military moving forward. One, because there's a culling happening. There's the forces that protect this country are being gerrymandered right now by these dumbass mandates, and people are going to leave en masse. I'm sure you have friends that are on their way out right now because of it.
Absolutely.
And I worry. I don't know who the leaders are going to be moving forward. Is it going to be people who think that leadership is holding a sign up somewhere and doing that, or is it somebody who I tell people this a lot of people on the conservative and libertarian side, and a lot of people in the middle and the liberal folks as well feel this way, that there's so many problems they can't deal with it, like they can't figure out where to start, paralysis by analysis so much. There's just so much going on. How can I possibly do something? Well, you can't end hunger, but you can end that motherfucker's hunger right now. Right. And somebody's going to see you doing that, and you become a force multiplier when you do the right thing. It's the opposite of the bystander effect.
Yeah.
Which is something that's come up recently because apparently a dude raped a woman for 40 minutes on a fucking train and nobody said or did anything.
That's crazy to me, which at least there's the other side of that coin with that dude in fucking Arizona.
The Marine,
It's
funny. So, he stole your line on Dana Perino's show this morning.
Yeah, no, I mean, that's fucking really great. Funny. It's good that it's still going. but the thing with that, I think, again, is it comes back to that lack of being shown the example from the start. Mm-hmm. I mean, we've been to other places where that's not at all part of a society, and you see what the effects of that are.
Right.
You know, it's basically a zero value in terms of what people put on the worth of somebody's life and what they care about and how they maintain their shit and how they, run their lives, you know, all the way up to the entire country. So, it's a huge fucking problem, and it's one that I think is going to bite us in the ass sooner than later. But just if we can go a little bit back to in terms of the childhood, was there, you know, it was shitty with your dad growing up. Like, what was the overall experience like that kind of led up to making you decide, you know what, I'm going to join the army and be a fucking.
Well, it's funny you say that because I didn't have a good relationship with him, and I didn't have a good relationship with my grandfather either. Because he was kind of a old school racist, like a real, not the way that old people are racist and they say off color stuff. Because now apparently the phrase person of color is offensive now too. Do you know that?
I didn't know that.
So now that's.
I'm not offended by that though.
I don't care. Yeah, but the old people used different lanyards than we did. And, you know, under today's rules, I guess they would consider racist. But he was an actual hateful piece of shit, right? Yeah. But he was in the 11th Airborne and jumped into Luzon in the Philippines during World War II.
No shit.
My dad was in the 101st, right? And then he was down in Gulag in Panama training jungle warfare for years. And I'm like the fourth generation infantry, third generation airborne infantry.
No shit.
My thinking was I was going to join the military because at some point during the process of me figuring out that my brain worked a little bit differently, I was like, all right, well, how can I use this to benefit myself? That was my first thinking, and that was wrong. I should have figured out how to use it to benefit everyone, because that's how a rising tide lifts all boats. We've all heard this phrase, right? And MLK used to say, you've got two hands for a reason, one to pull yourself up and one to pull up the next guy with.
One to push the other guy out of the way.
Yeah. Push him in front of the bear so you can get away. Yeah. I've always, since I was like in my late teens, I really started to believe in that shit. So I kind of wondered, what's a guy that's, I have a lot of physical capabilities. I've played baseball and soccer and basketball and shit. I was pretty athletic. And I didn't really get rattled too much because I dealt with so much shit growing up. I'm like, well, military seems like a good idea, right? Get some experience there and see if any of the shit makes any sense. And it was after 9/11, obviously. I mean, 9/11 happened, and then I was in college, so I finished that. And then went I joined DEP, delayed entry, in 04, and then I actually went in 05. And, you know, it was, I wanted to be, I didn't have the ego to think that I would be an operator right off the bat. You know what I mean? It just seemed like, because I knew a lot of those people at the time, like, it seems weird to me that you can just go into the military and have no combat experience and become an operator and do that. Maybe I was wrong at the time, I don't know, but the 82nd Airborne seemed like the best choice, right?
Because
they're pretty good at doing stuff. And you, from what I understood from people I knew that were in the division, if you fuck around, they will fuck you up, right? Yeah. And kick your ass out of the division and put you in a leg unit somewhere. I'm like, all right, that's cool. There's a standard. And I think it's a way to hold yourself accountable as well. I mean, if you hang around with shitbags, you're going to become one real quick.
Yeah.
Right. And if you hang around with people that are better and smarter than you, then you're going to become better and smarter. You have to survive. You know what I mean? That's just the way we work as human beings. So that's why I joined the 82nd Airborne specifically. And I had a good time there.
Yeah.
I thought, I mean, there's a lot of stupid bullshit you got to deal with.
Is that all at Benning?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, no, Bragg. The airborne training is at Benning, but.
Then you go to Bragg.
Second to Bragg, yeah.
Yeah. I would like to talk just a little bit about your experience there, if you don't mind sharing it. What did you go to, Iraq or Afghanistan?
Iraq, yes. Yeah. So we were in December 2006.
So right at the slow time.
Yeah. Yeah. We were on DRF-1. If you're not familiar with that, it's Division Ready Force. It's like the unit in the 18th Airborne Corps, but it's always the 82nd that's on 18-hour recall. So we have to deploy within 18 hours anywhere in the world, blah, 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 the whole shit. We get the call on, we were on leave actually for Christmas, get the call on the 27th, and I think we were in Iraq at Camp Taji by like the 2nd of January or something like that. So it was a pretty quick turnaround. We were the first unit deployed in the surge.
Oh, okay.
So we went to, I guess they sent our unit out there, my battalion, to kind of establish the tempo in an area that hadn't seen American forces. We were about 800 meters away from Sadr City. So we went there to fuck shit up. You know what I mean? We had pretty good air support. Jared Taylor, from Black Rifle, he was our JTAC. Yeah. So we had a fun team. He and I just trolled the shit out of people the whole time.
Yeah.
Him especially. He would fuck with people so much.
That's fucking great.
He was an E-4 in the Air Force at the time, and he was carrying around this fake-ass relaxed standard document, relaxed grooming standard document. And the sergeant major of my battalion wouldn't, he would just fuck with him every day. And he was like, hey, man, I don't know what to tell you. I might have to go somewhere, so whatever. But it was completely fake.
I can't shave.
Yeah, but it was, you know, if you dictate the terms, time in terms of combat, you do pretty well. We're maybe 400, 500 people, maybe like 250, 300 shooters. And this abandoned shopping mall, four-story building in the middle of the goddamn city, which is not a great place to be.
Yeah.
Because we got mortared every fucking day. But we were very violent. You know, I remember one time being on Overwatch, and this dude walks out. His kids are playing in the little, in those empty areas in between huts or houses in Iraqi neighborhoods. His kids are playing around. And he walks out and looks up and sees us, and then walks over to the wall and draws a double A on the wall. And we're like, yeah. And he fucking grabbed his kids and took them back inside. And I was like, wow, that was pretty neat.
That's a fucking trip.
But yeah, we lost four dudes.
How big of a unit was the one that you were intimately operating with?
Well, I mean, I started out as the, at the company level, I was the company RTO, and we kind of rolled around and set up, we were kind of a mobile command and control element, because we would do two or three patrols to talk to local dicks during the day. And then every night we would do raids almost every night. So, then I went down to the platoon level and did that for a while, but it was, most of our operations were company level. So that's like maybe 120 shooters, something like that.
Yeah.
And it's, you know, Solder City's right over there. There's about 4 million people there. And we would go over there from time to time. We would get intel that some asshole is over there, or a weapons cache or something, would ISR would spot it, and we would just drive over there and fight our way in, blow that shit up, and then fight our way back out.
Yeah.
It was interesting.
Yeah.
A lot of good gunfights. I mean, I know that sounds stupid, but you know what I'm talking about.
Yeah, no, I mean, it's interesting. I think most people without intimate knowledge of going over there or knowing somebody that's explained it is that there is a weird kind of luck of the draw in a lot of ways. You know, sometimes you go on a deployment and a lot of shit happens, and sometimes nothing happens. You know, I mean, it's just, and it doesn't have anything to do with, you know, who you are as a unit. In most cases, I mean, sometimes it is, but because there's politics with, you know, blue versus green and all that other shit. But
well, we did help. One of the things we ran into was, well, first of all, it's Muqtada al-Sadr's area, right?
Yeah,
that guy's a real cunt. He might become prime minister now.
Yeah, which he's is fucking inbred, right?
Yeah, yeah. He was. He actually is a lot like Muhammad, wherein he was illiterate until he was like a fucking adult, right?
Really,
had a lot of trouble speaking and stuff like that. But anyways, his organization, Jaish al-Mahdi, the Mahdi Army, you know, they were more. I think they were less about fighting Americans so much, although a lot of people did it to make money, like the bounties on American lives. They would try to ID people and snipe people, and they would get paid for it and shit. But mostly it was like crime.
Yeah.
It was like they're trying to push Sunnis out of their real estate in the local area in Bader and Shab and shit like that. And we were trying to stop them. So we stood up this kind of ragtag group of, they said they were previously untrained, but some of them clearly were Iraqi army before, called the Sons of Iraq, which eventually became ISIS in Iraq. So you're welcome for that, I guess.
Our pleasure.
Yeah. I mean, we've been creating our own enemies for a while now.
Yeah. For it's kinda, the whole time, I think. In terms of the four guys that you lost, was it four separate instances or?
Yeah, we had, well, I mean, it's four while we were there, but quite a few more. Like I've had, 11 friends get killed in combat, but I've had fucking over 20, I think 23 now, commit suicide after, or not all of them are technically suicide. Some of them are overdoses, but a guy that's been fucking in pain for 15 years that finally takes too much or something, to me, that's a slow death. You know what I mean? But yeah, three of them were, three were snipers, and one kid was an FSE. He was like a support guy. He was on a tower guarding the base one day, and some dude just popped around a corner and got a lucky shot off with an RPG and just popped right into him. But the rest of them were, I think they were, yeah, they were all snipers in the same area, actually.
Were they turret gunners that got sniped, or was it the
patrolling? They were foot mobile, all of them. Yeah.
At that time, did you guys have any intel of the opposition forces, of any of the snipers being outside of Iraq? I mean, I know there were a lot of rumors of Chechnya and fucking, you know, but I don't know how valid all of it is. I'm sure some of it is, or I know some of it is, but did you know anything at the time?
There were rumors in our AO of a Czech guy and then a Syrian guy, but I mean, we never confirmed any of that. We caught one sniper, and But, you know, it's not like we did a ballistics report to see if he was... We found a rifle that was the same caliber as some of our guys getting shot and shot at, but
yeah,
who the fuck knows, yeah, man. I mean, honestly, in Iraq, if you start a campaign where you're like, hey, we'll pay you X amount of dollars if you can tell us who did this, it's a guy with a... It's a sniper. They know what a sniper is. They'll just fucking find somebody in the neighborhood they don't like and say, yeah, he's got a sniper rifle, go arrest him. And then yeah, we arrest him, and who the fuck knows if any of that stuff's real, you know what I mean?
Yeah. No, and that's, I think, one of the biggest challenges is because it's such a tribal area, you know, a lot of that happens is that, you know, depends on something as simple as an interpreter, you know, doesn't like, you know, his family clan doesn't get along with this other one, and they pinpoint that, which is a shitty fucking deal. But, you know, honestly, I mean, as much as I hate to say it, I think the reality is that, you know, with what you're seeing here in this country, I think the same shit would happen here under those circumstances.
Oh, yeah. I mean, you're already seeing it. People.
Yeah, I mean, just over masks and vaccines and fucking toilet paper, you're seeing people act like total fucking savages. It's unbelievable.
Yeah, it's I mean, that's how fear works, though, I guess. People worry about resources. They worry about their own personal safety. And I think that's a mistake. I think it puts you in the wrong headspace.
Yeah.
Looking after other people is usually what puts you in the right headspace. Like that Marine, when he was on Fox this morning, people were, I think it was Dana Perino was asking him, like, were you surprised by that? He goes, I mean, no, I mean, I'm always thinking about safety and security, not for me, but for my family. So it just, it follows me around everywhere I go. And I think that's a hard thing for people that have done war to explain to people that haven't. Like, why are you carrying your gun with you to the backyard? Like, because what if?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I mean, it's why not?
It's like, well, you know, the odds of that happening, it's like, well, it's the same fucking odds when I get in my car. I still put my fucking seatbelt on, you know, like, yeah, like that, like even with as many people as die in car crashes, like your chances of dying aren't very great,
right?
You know, but they're there. And so, yeah, why the fuck not? So when you got out, can you talk about your transition out and what that looked like and kind of transitioning into what you do now? Like, where did that come from and how did that all transpire?
Yeah, I didn't know what the fuck I was doing, to be honest. I mean, I had kind of a vague idea. I had 2 degrees at the time. So, you know, there's a lot of stuff I could have done, but
one of them was a religious study,
comparative religion. Yeah. And then the other one was computer network security.
So dick measuring Bible studies. And what? And computer science.
Computer security, yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Yep. No wonder. And then, so the first thing I did when I got out, I did some bodyguard work here and there just because it seemed, you know, natural, I guess, because I'm already hyper aware. I'm already trained on the weapon system. I can do that while I'm figuring other shit out. And it worked out pretty well. I mean, I did some cool stuff. I did some work for, Morrison Forrester, big law firm out there. I did a lot of the workplace violence interdiction for Wells Fargo and Gap Inc. and a bunch of companies out, because I was in Oakland at the time. So I was working. Oh, yeah.
So you lived it.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. And I worked in San Francisco. So it wasn't quite as big a shithole back then, but it was on its way. You could tell, right?
Did you go there for that job?
No, I went with a woman I was dating.
Oh, okay. I was going to say, what the fuck brought you out there?
No. Well, I mean, yeah, basically. But I did that for a little bit. And got another degree in security management, right? Because I wanted some kind of management degree. And that one seemed like a normal one. And then as I was doing that, continued doing, I kind of moved more into the risk and threat assessment stuff because I'm just good at making plans and things like that.
Is it, not to interrupt, but is any of that, why do people say that? Of course you do mean to interrupt, right?
Yeah.
Like, not to interrupt, but I'm going to. In terms of the high functioning Asperger stuff, is can you explain A, what that is, and B, are there benefits in relation to stuff like that that come from it? Like almost Rain Man kind of shit.
Yeah, I think you make connections better, right? Like people think in different ways. They think about. Well, let's think about it from a philosophical standpoint. Some people think about what is, and some people think about what ought to be, right? People that spend too much time thinking about is never make any progress, and people who spend too much time thinking about what ought to be never face fucking reality, right? And I think people that are high functioning like that are able to do a little bit of both, and it helps. Yeah. It definitely has been a huge benefit. Like when I was younger, it was kind of a pain in the ass because I didn't understand what was going on. But as soon as I figured it out, it was a huge benefit to me. Now, not in my personal relationships necessarily. That's something that I've had to develop over time, but certainly in my professional life, it was very useful.
What are the drawbacks from it?
People expect you to act a certain way, right? Like when something exciting that's exciting to them happens, they expect you to be excited for them, but my brain just doesn't work like that, right? And I'm...
So people think you're like emotionally dead a lot of the time.
Yes, correct. Yeah. But I think that's a big misunderstanding about folks like us, where we feel things very deeply, actually. It's just that we don't display that shit.
Yeah.
It's different because when I feel something, the first thing I do is like, why am I feeling this, and making checklists. Is this an appropriate thing to feel at this time? Because I want to, like, emotion is a very powerful tool and I want to be using it correctly.
Yeah.
But people don't think like that. They just think, well, those are my emotions. They should be respected. And to some degree, that's true, but it's on you to fucking figure out all that stuff for yourself, right?
Well, yeah. And I think, you know, here's where the line between, the term, say, controlling your emotions, I think is a bordering on dangerous one. I don't think you should try to control your emotions. You should embrace your emotions. You need to control your actions based on your emotions. And while that may seem semantics to a lot of people, I think that's really important, is that, you know, you shouldn't try to suppress how you feel. You should think about it, analyze it, you know, whether you want to call it processing it or letting it run its course, whatever. Just don't let your actions, be uncontrolled based on what those emotions are.
Yeah, I agree with that. I mean, it's, to go back to the philosophical thing, when you map that onto just daily life or science or something like that, there are people who ask how and people who ask why, right? Like, some people want to know how something works and some people want to know why it happened. And I think high functioning people are able to do both of those things simultaneously. It's almost like thinking, you know how an architect can think three dimensionally, right? But when it comes to physical objects, I think people like this are able to do that, think three dimensionally and like social and spatial things, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's just a little bit different. So it's certainly helpful, but in the people have a certain expectation of you, obviously. I mean, there's memes out there about me where it's the same picture four times, and it says happy, angry, hungry, horny, or something like that. I mean, my face just always looks the same.
Yeah.
Which is fine, but it's, and like I said earlier, 83% or so of communication is nonverbal, and that's a problem. And in a relationship, you've got to be communicating with one another quite a bit, right? If you're around each other all the time.
Well, so, you should be.
Yeah.
You just send them a text.
Yeah. Or you get those little plush toys that you fold inside and outside, depending on what your mood is, and set it on the desk.
The Fogo to Chow red and green card.
Yeah. I always forget to put that flag down and I end up with the meat sweats. At the end.
That's a good problem to have.
Yeah, it is.
So you run into the honey, we're pregnant. You're like, all right, I'll head to Target and start stocking up on diapers. Like, you don't even fucking.
Pretty much. I mean, I irritate the shit out of her all the time because she'll tell me something and I immediately start fixing the issue.
Yeah.
And that's not something that women always want.
They want to be heard
first. And then they want to, you know, maybe you fix the issue on your own time. I think it's interesting though, because people who are fixers like that don't feel appreciated, but it's you're wrong. The reason she doesn't listen to or engage in the fixing part of it is because she knows you're going to do that.
Yeah,
like that's trust. That's a nonverbal form of trust that she's giving you right now. I know you're going to take care of it. Let's just talk about it first. I'm like, all right, cool.
Yeah, I mean, I think being heard is important for everybody. I do think women tend to lean on that probably a little heavier than men, but
are you saying there are differences between men and women?
No, there is no difference. Good. There's not even a such thing as a man and a woman anymore. Ain't that right, Zohan? All right, so I guess back to the question. We got off the tangent as I interrupted, even though I didn't mean to.
Well, of course not.
So when you got out of the military, how did you go from moving to San Francisco with some split tail, doing some security stuff, to doing what you do now?
Well, there's more steps. So after I finished the management degree, I went to Penn State and got a master's degree in Homeland Security with a focus in international border security.
Like at State College, fucking.
I went up there a lot, but I didn't. It was mostly correspondence, to be honest. All the professors in that program are mostly like either DOD or contractor employees of DOD and work in the intelligence communities and all that shit.
Yeah.
So it was actually really good because you get to learn. It's almost like how basic training worked in Vietnam, where guys came from combat right back to basic training and taught guys immediately what they had just learned because they knew they were deploying immediately. You know what I mean? So it was a pretty fun time there. And while I was doing that, I did intel work for USCIS for immigration.
No shit. Yeah. So it's your fault.
Yeah. All right. Yeah. I left after about a year because I was like, fuck, man.
Yeah.
And it was in San Francisco, right? So that's a Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals. And every time we would build these cases, we would send them up to ICE. And ICE is like, this looks great, but, you know, we'll have the U.S. attorney come tell you the same thing. If we take this to court, the Ninth Circuit's going to butt fuck us and create bad case law. Yeah. So people were just punting at the time, waiting for Obama to leave.
Yeah. Were you there when that gal got shot on the pier and fucking by the...
No, that was a couple. That was 2017, right? So it was a couple months after I left, I think.
Oh no! Yeah, I guess for some reason I'm misremembering it. I thought it was during Obama, but fuck, who knows? I mean, obviously, if you weren't there,
it was Katie Stein. Oh, it was 2015. Yeah, I was there. Yep, by the illegal immigrant. By the way, this guy, the rapist from the train, also here illegally.
Yeah, I guess he's from Congo. I think.
Yeah, he's Congolese. Came on a student visa in 2012.
Yeah,
and. Sexually assaulted a woman in 2015. Served 90 days in prison.
Yeah, well, I guess they reviewed his visa and all of that, and basically said, "Yeah, even though you've overstayed it and you've committed crimes, we don't deem you a threat, and you can stay." Mm-hmm. And then that happened. Like,
yeah, that didn't age well. Yeah, so I worked for Homeland Security for a little bit, and just obviously became disaffected with that. And because of my degree, and then I had time and service and shit like that, I started getting a lot of offers from other agencies, ATF and shit like that, to come do intel for them. I'm like, this is fucking stupid. I'm not doing this. I mean, I appreciate the top secret security clearance and shit, but I wouldn't
mind federal creds to carry everywhere.
Yeah, I know, right?
But
what's it? HR 2 something?
215. 215, yeah.
215? Yeah, that'd be nice. Well, no, 218 is the police officer one, yeah. Anyways, yeah. Sometime in... late 2016, Jared called me. He's like, hey, why don't you come out to SHOT Show and meet Evan Hafer,
who's
the CEO of Black Rifle. I'm like, all right, I mean, cool. I don't have anything going on, but why? He goes, well, I want you to come work for us. I'm like, I don't know what the fuck.
I don't know shit about coffee.
Yeah, I don't know why. I didn't know anything about coffee at the time. And he's like, no, doing intel is pretty much the same as doing marketing. I mean, it's you're just looking at psychographic information and data and predicting how people are going to react to certain things. And also, you're fucking funny. We do a lot of stupid shit here. I'm like, all right, cool. So I met up with Evan at SHOT Show in 2017, dicked around a little bit, stayed there a couple of days, and I was working there by April.
Nice.
At Black Rifle, moved to Salt Lake City. And that was a good time. I enjoyed working there. Good group of dudes. Learned a lot of stuff.
Yeah. Were you doing all marketing at that point?
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I was there for about... I guess about 2 months, and then we formed a presidential board that I was on to help guide where the company was going to go and reestablish some stuff. You know how it is with a startup. At some point, you got to turn it into a real company that does shit the right way. We're doing it with fucking Drinking Bros / Tetherball right now. It's a pain in the ass, like hiring actual human beings to do stuff. Like, it's funny. I've gotten over it at this point, but at first it was like, damn, am I an idiot? Because everything I'm doing is wrong this whole time. But yeah, I was there for sometime that fall in 2017. I just started. The guys were already doing Drinker Bros, and I'd done it here and there with them a little bit. But I'm like, you know, you can make a lot of money on this stuff, so we should turn it into a business. It kind of went back and forth. We didn't have a lot of time to do it, so I just started doing some of the shows. Ross and I started the sports show and started traveling to all these events. And then by 2018, I got really into it, traveling around and stuff and splitting time. And we got to the point as a company where I realized we had outgrown my ability to fucking do shit, right? So we hired this person that is very, very good at their job, right? That to replace me as VP of marketing. And then I went on just to do Drink Your Bros. And we were, they were going through a growth period at the time. And we kind of had a discussion about the CEO and two vice presidents of the largest direct-to-consumer coffee company in the world, which is true. They're like, I think they have like 11% of the market share for global direct-to-consumer coffee or some shit like that. Can't be on a show like this daily talking about weird shit.
Yeah.
Right? Saying fucked up shit. Talking about how the Battle of Thermopylae was just a giant gay orgy. Right? Which is on one of the episodes. So we're like, all right, cool. Well, we'll just do this and you guys do the other thing, we'll buy you out of it and we'll keep. I mean, we're that's just it worked out at the time. And then, you know, we started turning it into a real business. And you know, it is you do the same thing, producing all this content. We do a lot more than you do, obviously, because we have a lot more shows, but
yeah,
it's even at this level, it's a pain in the fucking ass.
Yeah. I mean, that's why I do it as infrequent or intermittently as I do is because it's not the main thing of what I do. You know,
right.
It's not what's keeping the lights on. I mean, for sure, it's obviously worth doing and I enjoy doing it. But yeah, I mean, there's some months where I don't put out a single episode for the entire fucking month, you know, and then there's some where I'll put out four, you know? Mm. So yeah, it just totally depends, but I'm there with you. I mean, it's tough to constantly just keep putting out good content that people like. I mean, it's fucking exhausting on top of it, you know, but
it's definitely mentally exhausting. And I feel in today's climate, it's starting to get to the point where I feel a lot of responsibility to keep doing it because there's not a lot of sane voices of people. You know, when people get scared, they retreat to their corners. Mm-hmm. Like I'm a Republican because I believe these six things. So I've got to defend any Republican. I'm like, no, dude. Principles, not people.
Yeah.
We have the Constitution is a list of principles that are supposed to be universally applicable. That's the whole point. And liberty only exists if it exists for everybody.
Yeah.
Right. And if people have these tendencies to just accept the narrative of their own party because that's the easy thing to do.
Yeah.
And I think that's a mistake. So what I primarily focus on is telling people how stupid their fucking beliefs are, basically. Yeah. Right. And it's not an insult. It's like, you've got to do more work. You have to figure this shit out. You have to go through these processes. Don't depend on Fox and don't depend on CNN to tell you how to think and feel.
Yeah.
Because that's only going in one direction, and that's the direction they want it to go. Do you want that? I mean, who wants that shit?
Yeah. Well, and I think with that too, I mean, I think we talked about this on the show I was on, but the other day was, you know, your position, right? And whatever fucking side of whatever fence you're on is that, you know, you should invite being challenged in your position.
It's a Socratic method, you know? Right?
Yeah. And if A, you can't defend them, or B, are not willing to, you probably need to take a real hard look at what that position is and maybe change it, because that's what I see, you know, overwhelmingly in the media. And even in some instances on, say, Fox or Breitbart or Daily Wire or wherever, you know, that's not engulfed in left wing, you know, mainstream media wings, is that, you know, you still can't just live in an echo chamber where nobody is saying, well, you know, okay, that doesn't make sense. Here's why it doesn't make sense. And then you fucking explain it. You know, like that just doesn't happen anywhere.
No, it doesn't. It's unfortunate too. That's why I like to have liberal people come on my show, American Party especially, to talk to them about specifically about political stuff.
Yeah.
So I had this hour and a half long conversation with this dude, Alec Ross, the other day, as I mentioned before. And he, you know, he's one of those guys that thinks that corporations should pay more taxes than the fact that the effective tax rate of Facebook being lower than their lowest earning employee is probably a problem. And I agree with him. That is a problem. But I said, you're operating from the premise that we need X amount of dollars and that they have to come from somewhere. So we may as well take them from rich people. Challenge that first premise. We don't need this much money. The government doesn't need this much money to function. They need to provide common defense, roads, and you know, other safety measures and healthcare measures and shit like that. Now, I'm not saying there should be completely
basic infrastructure.
I'm not saying there should be completely socialized medicine or anything like that. But I don't, not, and nothing is free. Forget about the free healthcare thing. But telling people in the richest country in the history of the world that they can be as healthy as they can afford to be is amoral at best, in my opinion. I think that's fucked up.
Yeah, I think it's criminal.
So, and if you think, this is the challenge I bring back to liberal folks all the time that voted for Obama. You think Obamacare is anything more than a handout to the pharmaceutical industry and the insurance industry? You haven't read the fucking bill.
Yeah.
Right? Honestly, it's all it is. They didn't challenge pharmaceutical prices at all. And they gave more and more money, administrative fees, to the insurance companies. And it's the same thing that happened in public education in the United States at the secondary level. So university professors' pay has gone up over the last 30 years, something like 27 to 35%, depending on what region you're in. Administrative fees overall have gone up 2,000%.
Yeah.
So all this bloat at the top, and it's just a reflection of the government. It's the same thing, and I don't want to hear it from Republicans either, because your guy, George W. Bush, presided over the largest expansion of the federal government in the history of this country.
Yeah.
I just don't want to hear that shit.
And especially with the No Child Left Behind shit that steamrolled nonsense. Everybody. And
like you're tying test scores to funding? Are you fucking kidding me?
Yeah, I mean, it exacerbated the problem that the Department of Education started back when it, you know, started in 79.
The Department of Education sounds sinister to me.
Yeah, yeah. It's doesn't like it? Some shit out of Hogwarts or whatever,
dude,
you know? Like,
what the fuck does that even mean?
Department yeah, no, it's fucking terrible. And I almost wonder, I mean, you're starting to see slight shifts this way. And I think at this point, we're far enough down the spiral or far enough down the drain education system-wise to where going back to where it's like small cooperatives based on, you know, neighborhoods and towns and whatever of like, okay, this neighborhood has 16 fucking kids between the age of whatever and whatever. Sally, you know, can teach this. Fucking John can teach these things. We're going to all pool our fucking.
I mean, that's the way it worked for a long time.
For a long time. And that's how it worked better. I mean, if you taken a look at, and this is for anybody watching, if you want to really highlight and slap yourself in the face with a dick in terms of understanding how far gone we are education system wise is look at education materials, textbooks, etc. from back, you know, 80 or 100 years ago and what was being taught then versus what's being taught now. It's fucking staggering, you know, how much better the education system was, even in small networks that weren't governed by one big entity back then versus now. Like the collective average is, I mean, it's embarrassing, you know.
Yeah, the preparedness for secondary education, which is to say college or whatever, trade school or whatever, is markedly better for homeschooled kids than it's for publicly educated kids.
Well, and even with that, I think, you know, college, I mean, I've met, I don't know how many fucking college graduates, even people with masters, et cetera. Mm-hmm. Like to me, unless it's for engineering, fucking, you know, some sort of medical profession, something specialized like that, college is about the biggest fucking Ponzi scheme in existence.
Especially now. I mean, it used to be affordable. Bill O'Reilly used to love telling this story. This was at the very beginning of the debate over student loans and shit. late 2000s, I guess. And he used to say, I painted houses in the summertime to pay my way through Harvard. Like, good luck doing that now, asshole.
Yeah.
It's like $150,000 there.
Yeah. Yeah, a year.
Like, you're not, that's not happening anymore.
Yeah.
But yeah, college, it's funny how I think everybody is just copying and pasting job postings because there's college requirements for weird shit. Like, it doesn't matter what degree you have, just any degree. And I from the perspective of seeing if somebody has gone through the process to learn how to do formal writing, I guess, or that they can finish something they started, sure, that's fine. But there's a lot of ways to do that without putting them in $100,000 in debt.
Yeah,
because right, there's a trickle-down effect from that debt.
Yeah.
The way that the middle class in America creates wealth over the course of their lifetime is primarily through the mortgage in their home. That's the most wealth that most middle-class people make. And now you're taking people who used to be buying their starter homes between 26 and 28, now they can't afford that until their mid to late 30s for their first home that they ever buy. There's a huge gap in the marketplace, and a home is something that everybody needs. Rentals have gone up from 43% of the country to 60% of the country. So most people now, not just a plurality, but the majority of people are now renting homes, which means the middle class is no longer creating the wealth it once did.
Yeah.
That's a big fucking problem.
Yeah. Well, and it is, but you know, the thing where I think, you know, most people, I would say, struggle with that is the disparity between the top and bottom, I think is, I don't think, I mean, it is the largest it's ever been. Like, mm-hmm. the middle class almost doesn't exist anymore. Like, people are either wealthy or they're fucking pissed right. broke, which, you know, every country I've been to overseas that was a big fucking problem, that was also the case.
Yeah, like Venezuela, for example.
Yeah, I mean, fucking Iraq. I mean, even in a place that's as quote-unquote westernized as, say, United Arab Emirates, it's mm-hmm. still very much that way. Shit, there.
Kuwait's like that.
Yeah.
You but know? It's all like Indochinese slave labor over there, yeah. basically, because none of the Kuwaitis have real jobs because yeah. they get the oil dividend or whatever.
Yeah. No, I know it. I mean, when shit, just being in Bahrain, there were, on a regular basis, there were Indian and Pakistani fucking slaves throwing mm-hmm. themselves off of buildings because they were, you know, basically kidnapped, brought over and put into, you know, a 20-year fucking slave contract that at the end of it, they would have had about $13 to their name. You
it's
know.
The same thing we did to the Irish when they yeah. first came to America, right? Yeah. It's the indentured servitude bullshit. Mm-hmm. Except for, I mean, people like to talk about slavery like it's a thing of the past. There are 45 million slaves on earth right now,
yeah.
more than there have ever been in the history of this country, and that's a conservative estimate. Yeah. The history of the world, rather, not the country. It's a huge problem.
Yeah, yeah, one that only exists or doesn't exist as far as most people in this country. It's very specific and one-sided and still a cause of every fucking problem that that apparently exists. But
well, there are some issues I think today that still stem from that. So here's an example. We're talking about the middle class, the GI Bill after World War II and the VA home loan. Both of those things happened when Jim Crow was still in effect, right? So technically speaking, those black men and black men who served in the military during World War II, who were entitled to the GI Bill, they could get it from the government, but the university could tell them no. They could tell, that's why HBCU is historically black colleges and universities became a thing in the first place, right? So those folks would have a place to go get educated. They were excluded from that entire process, and they were excluded from the VA home loan process in most places in the South as well. And again, education and mortgages, that's how people create wealth over time. And we artificially created generational poverty and never solved it. And it's the thing that pisses me off is, well, there's two things. One is that the liberals used it to keep them coming back for votes, right? They don't give a shit about these people. They just want to fucking get their vote. And the Republicans or the conservatives from the 60s, 70s, and 80s, at least, they have the solution, which is personal entrepreneurship. Green. The only color that matters is green. Forget about, like, yeah, you want to get somebody through their tough time, but we've had this parable about teaching a man to fish instead of giving him one, as is at minimum 2,000 years old, right? At least 2,000 years old, because it was in the New Testament. But it was probably borrowed from a previous story. So let's say conservatively, it's 2,000, for 2,000 years we've known that it's far superior to teach somebody how to take control of their own goddamn life than it is to try to fucking baby them and assume that they can't figure out how to vote or get an ID or fucking hire a lawyer or whatever the fuck, right?
Yeah, I mean, to me, all of those things are very underhanded racist policies. Plain and simple. And to me, going back to towards the beginning of the show of the soccer analogy is, I mean, to me, it's that fucking ridiculous. Is that, you know, if you're saying, like, to me, to assume that any group of people can't do any of the things that if somebody who's not white, who's born somewhere outside of this country, can come here and do it no problem. Yeah. And you're going to assume that because, you know, in most cases, you know, because this group of black people is black, that they can't do that same thing. Like, how the fuck is that not racist?
Honestly, I can't figure that one out.
You know, and especially in a world where the term racist gets thrown around so much and frankly misused to the point where it doesn't even fucking make sense anymore, is that, you know, the textbook definition of racism is to think or assume that one race is superior to the rest, or that in this case, or in any case, that one race is inferior to another one. You know, so a stereotype, a fucking an assumption, you know, there's a lot of things that get thrown out there as being quote unquote racist that aren't. And at the same time, there's a lot of policies and things that are happening right in front of our fucking nose that are clearly fucking racist. Yep. in its most pure form, that get passed off as being empathetic or a good fucking political policy.
Yeah. Yeah. Tell me who's more empathetic. The person who pats you on the back as you're putting a fork into an electrical outlet, or the person who slaps it out of your hand and calls you an idiot and tells you to fucking wise up.
Yeah.
Because honestly, we have to have a discussion about what it means to care about people again.
Yeah.
because we've completely lost focus of what that means.
Yeah.
Coddling people does not work.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it enables them to continue to fucking be in the same position that they're in, which is, right, again, dependent on somebody else. And if that, I mean, anybody that looks at that and thinks that that's the good way to do it, like,
no, that's fucking stupid. Yeah, it used to be the social currency used to come from overcoming challenges, right?
Yeah.
Being in a bad spot, toughen it out, getting through it, and then coming out better on the other side. And then the addition to that would be helping other people do the same. Now the social currency is just in being the victim in the first place.
Yeah.
Like, we've lowered that all the way down here. So this process, this most important process in all of life, the same process that you go through to get in physical shape, to learn things, to whatever, this short-term discomfort has become completely untenable for these folks.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And that's the most important part of life. It's the only way you get anywhere. Yeah. Is through those short-term sacrifices.
Yeah. No, I'm right there with you. And I mean, it's the same thing as talking about earlier, like with the eustress of creating challenging situations for kids and people as they grow up, or childhood in general, is that, you know, creating a hard enough environment for people to not be entitled little shitbags. Do you have kids?
Brittany does. I don't. Okay. But yeah, we've got a 13-year-old in the house.
Yeah.
He's a good kid.
Yeah.
But he's entitled to shit. You know
yeah.
what I mean?
Yeah. Well, and you know, there was an interesting conversation I had with a Gold Star mom that came on the show just fairly recently. I'm sorry, a Gold Star wife. And, you know, we were talking about the difficulty that a lot of combat vets have in coming home from war environments, third world countries, where they see kids that are, you know, the same age as their own, that are living about as polar opposite life as could exist from their children, and seeing what those kids go through, how they're able to adapt, the resiliency that they have, the appreciation that they have for things that are, that everybody here takes for granted, you know, and then coming home and struggling with their own children seeming like these spoiled little entitled assholes because they're not like these kids. And one thing that I do think is important to kind of try to reconcile with that is that, and one of the comments that she said that I'll be forever grateful for helping, you know, flip my perspective or at least round it out some, is that, you know, what your kids would have to go through for them to have that appreciation would destroy their innocence.
Right.
Yeah. Which I think is valid. And, you know,
well, there's a point where your innocence has to be destroyed, right? It's like breaking the egg to make the omelet.
Yeah. But I think just like with everything, there has to be balance, you know, in the places we've been, it's imbalanced one way. Here it's imbalanced just the other direction. And so it's finding that happy medium. But I do think, at least for me, and I think for a lot of people that come home and struggle with that, because I think that's where a lot of tough relationships with veteran soldiers and their kids stem from, is that not at least having that as an understanding that they can balance out that just like, you know, almost resentment for their own fucking family because they're not like these other kids that have been bombed out of their fucking houses, right, you know, every other goddamn night.
Yeah, which is a completely irrational expectation of your own child who's grown up in relative comfort.
Yeah, I mean, with as easy a life as a human being could grow up in the history of mankind. All right, so once you stopped doing the marketing and you started this, can you walk us through the drinking bros / just the, I guess the podcast business in general of how that has come to where it is now?
Sure. Yeah. I mean, you gotta start with, I think it all starts with good content, to be honest. Baseball is having this problem right now, over the last couple of years. Like you said, you've been kind of disillusioned with the whole thing since the strike in 94. I think there's still quite a few people like that.
Yeah.
And they've had issues with work stoppages and steroid scandals and all this other bullshit. And the latest, I suppose, issue is that the games are too long and people are losing attention. I mean, to be honest, I don't know why they would care about that because they only sell beer until the seventh inning anyways. So, you know, after then, who gives a shit? But their idea was to try to speed up the game. I think if you've got a product, there's certainly something to be said for producing less of a product if the market's oversaturated. But if your first instinct is to shrink your product rather than fix it, I think is a problem, right? And I think a lot of people not necessarily are shrinking their shows, but they're just trying to go on whatever trends are happening that day. And that's not what people want to hear.
Yeah.
Honestly. So we tested out a lot of different things. One of our shows, Ross's show with his wife, Ross Patterson Revolution, doesn't do guests because they just don't do well. It's him and his wife talking about pop culture shit. And it's, why would you bring a guest onto that show? It doesn't make sense. It's they enjoy the back and forth between them. That's what the show
like,
is, right?
It's like Regis and Kathy Lee without the guest.
Yeah. And it, for us on Drinking Bros, it's people like the military aspect, but they also, you know, they like to see people with similar backgrounds to them, right? Because a lot of our audience is military, veteran, first responder. They like to see people with similar backgrounds to them having conversations with people that they wouldn't be able to, right? Like we've spoken to Matthew McConaughey, Neil deGrasse Tyson, all these motherfuckers, right? That otherwise, like I at no point did I assume that's going to be what this turned into, being able to meet famous people and talk to them and ask their opinions about shit. And then, you know, we started to develop more of a network, right? It's Rogan kind of did it a little bit with having all those comedians on his show, and they all kind of spawned off of him. Mm-hmm. All the other shows like Tom Segura and all those guys, but and actually a lot of the military people that have been on the show, right?
Yeah.
Had big success afterwards. So we're like, well, why don't we just do that? And we'll, instead of it ending there, we'll fucking actually help these people make the show as well, right?
Yeah.
So we kind of got into the network thing and started developing other shows and stuff like that. And then we started having to hire people to sell the advertising for, because I don't know what the fuck I'm doing. I mean, I do, but I'm not doing that. And then logistics, producers, nobody really does, up until the last couple of years. Like this setup you guys have is nice, but people weren't doing this. It was a webcam.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And it was low production quality, and nobody really knew how to do a lot of this stuff. And then once people stopped traveling over the last couple of years, doing Zoom interviews became a thing. We had to figure out all that tech. So it's, you know, we navigated through all that stuff, and we've got deals going on all the time and trying to develop new shows and stuff like that. And then productizing and stuff like, it's, you know, it's interesting. I every chance I get, I try to, instead of giving ourselves raises, to hire more people to do shit I don't want to do.
Yeah.
So I can just talk, so I can read, think, talk to people, figure shit out. And we do it a lot with the audience. Like we'll have a series of shows and blah, blah, blah. And then I'll be like, all right, we're going to do like a Q&A show today where we just talk to fans the whole time and see what they're thinking. Cause you know, like you want a good feedback loop, right?
Yeah.
You want to know that you're,
well, yeah, you got to listen to the customer.
Yeah, I mean,
at the end of the day, like your show is a product, and you have customers, and if you alienate all of them and talk about shit that nobody wants to hear, then you don't have a product anymore.
Right, but I mean, you can't go too far in the other direction. You don't want to completely tailor shit, because the purpose, I don't really give a fuck about the money and stuff like that. My purpose is to challenge people the way they think.
Mm-hmm.
I can make money doing anything. You know, it's like you were saying before, this is the land of opportunity. If you can figure out a few things, if you're kind of a generalist, like you can figure out how to do some media stuff and how to do some marketing stuff and then figure out products and things like that, you can do pretty much whatever the fuck you want, right?
Yeah.
But I like doing this because I can talk to a lot of people on both ends of the spectrum. And I feel like, back to the high functioning thing, the fact that I routinely ask how and why at the same time and combine that answer into something that's more makes it easy for me to be at the intersection between people who are going through regular life and trying to figure out what the fuck's going on and people who are actually influencing what's going on.
Yeah.
So I try to sit there, and I that's the responsibility I feel for doing that is great now.
So you're an influencer.
Yeah.
Where's the thong at?
We were at the Buc-ee's between here and Austin.
Yeah.
We stopped there to pee on the way up yesterday and grab some fucking snacks, and it's fucking 25-year-old white girls out there taking pictures with the Buc-ee, with the bronze Buc-ee. Like, get the fuck out of here, dude.
Yeah, that's fucking
it's hilarious.
Do you have like 5, 10, 20 year, like, is there a benchmark or flagship goal that you have with Drinking Bros and your company?
Not really, no. I mean, we talk about, we have a CFO and we talk about stuff like that, but I mean, I know a lot about the business, so I'm like, yeah, let's go in this direction, but I steer us away from directions that are going to become censorship problems in the future, right? Yeah. I don't like that stuff. So I guess in that way, I do have benchmarks, but there's not like a dollar amount I'm going to hit where I'm going to stop.
Or I mean, I guess like when you're 60, do you want to still be doing this?
It depends on where we may be living in the woods by then. You know what I mean? Who knows?
We're lucky.
I enjoy doing it. I enjoy the conversation. We go do live events and hang out with fans and shit all the time. We have a great fan base. Yeah. So I enjoy doing that stuff. And I'm sure I'll get sick of it at some point, right?
Yeah.
I mean, I'm more of a thinker and a writer than I am a talker. So the public, I mean, because of my, I guess if you want to call it a condition, I'm not a huge fan of being in public and doing stuff like that. I do it to challenge myself. I originally started doing all this in front of camera just to challenge myself, right? Because I knew it was something that was uncomfortable for me, and fuck that, right? I'm not going to allow something to be uncomfortable for me.
Yeah, that's why I sit on lampshades all day long. Fuck that, I'm going to get used to it. So, I mean, that was one of my questions too that I have written down is the why. Is there anything above and beyond what you've already said? I mean, you've pretty well explained it, but I'll throw it out there just as a follow up, I guess. Is there a specific why outside of those two things, or does that encompass it pretty well?
That's certainly, those two things are part of it. But the real reason is because if you can do something to help and you don't, then the bad shit that happens is your fault, right? And we're all fucked up right now. There's no, people are having a really hard time staying rational because everything is so charged emotionally. And somebody has got to be the adult in the room and walk around and say, hey, calm the fuck down and let's talk about this shit.
Yeah.
And that's why we developed a list of principles for the American Party. I'll read them actually, because I think I'd love to hear your audience's take. Maybe they can comment on YouTube and shit and let me know what they think about it. But the first one is just the oath of enlistment, right? I'll support and defend the Constitution of the United States against all enemies, foreign and domestic. I think that's pretty obvious. That's not something that you should only buy into if you're in the military or a police officer or a politician. That should be the standard for every fucking person walking around here, even if you're new and you haven't, maybe if you're just a green card holder, that should be the first password to get in here. Like, yeah, we're going to make this place the best. Stop talking about how we're the best. Yeah, stop talking about how we're the fucking best. And start making this place the best, asshole. You know what I mean? Two is, I'll do something every day to help my country, my countrymen, or all men. And I think that's less about just generally being empathetic or helping people, and more so about, that is the path to happiness, in my opinion, or contentment or whatever, especially if you're a man. Like, your job is to help people and protect people. And if you don't do that, you're going to feel some hole inside you for your entire life.
Yeah, purpose.
Three is, I will not allow those less fortunate or incapable of defending themselves to be harmed or taken advantage of in my country. And that's the responsibility. If you have power and you are expected to wield it responsibly, I think is a pretty reasonable thing to ask of people. But it seems like a lot of people, their first instinct when they have power is to protect their own power. That's what politics in America is now, right?
It is. I think the one tricky part with that, at least from my perspective, and, you know, by all means, give me your input on it, is people's interpretation of what is dangerous or not.
Right, yeah, yeah.
Right, is that if I think you not taking a fucking vaccine is dangerous for me and for you, then I'm like, that's where it's a slippery fucking area of wielding your power in what you think is people's best interest.
Right,
you know?
Yeah, yeah. I mean, it's... That's stupid, by the way.
Oh, agreed.
Like, if you're vaccinated, then I'm no threat to you.
Yeah, no, I mean, I had, do you know Mike Simpson?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I had him on last week. In fact, his episode dropped on Patreon this morning, but we had a fairly, I'd say almost half the fucking interview was, you know, masks and vaccines and going through his book on kind of the health and fitness aspects of it. And, I mean, I was just, he's pro vaccine and I'm just like, I don't get it. I was like, you know, if let's say the mortality rate is fucking 40%.
Well, is he pro vaccine or pro mandate?
No, I mean, right. pro vaccine, okay. but even with that, it's like, and agreed, good point. Like there's a big difference between those two, but even with that, it's like, you know, to me, if he says, I still think as a doctor, I still think you should get it. Mm. Okay. Why? It's like, well, there's no real good answer to that. Like if 99.7% chance of not dying from it exists just with my own immunity and it doesn't keep me from getting it or giving it to somebody,
right.
then how could you possibly as a fucking doctor in good conscience recommend getting that?
Yeah. Like, I mean, if you've got any questions about that whole debate, just go watch Rogan Gupta. That was hilarious. I've never seen a medical professional be eviscerated by a guy that never went to school.
I still haven't watched it. I mean, I gotta watch it.
It's wild, but yeah, you're right about that. It's not about, it's about money.
Yeah.
That's all that is. Money and power, right?
Yeah. Well, you know, one of the things I brought up with him, and I even brought it up with my kid's family fucking physician, right? Is that we went in there for a school physical fucking, you know, right before school started just a couple months ago. And, you know, they're wearing masks and talking about it and all that. And I got into it with him and he said, no bullshit. He's like, yeah, then I just don't even care. He's like, I don't even care about you. Like if you're not, you know, on board with masks and vaccines and like, I don't even care. And I was like, so that whole Hippocratic Oath thing is shoved right up your ass then.
Yeah, yeah.
And I was, you know, in thinking about it, and I brought this up with Mike on the last show, sorry for you that have already watched Mike's show and are now hearing it again. But, is that, you know, in no other regard with people's personal choices is that applicable. Like, oh, you smoke? Fuck you then. You don't get chemo. Like, because at this point, like if you smoke in 2021, you know that shit is bad for you.
Yeah, yeah.
Right? If you're a total fat fuck, you know, and you eat fucking Snickers bars and wash them down with Dr. Pepper all fucking day long and you're type 2 diabetic and they're about to cut your foot off because you're so fucked up. Like that's akin to saying, no, like you want to make shitty choices? Fuck you. Get out of my office. Right. Like that's no different.
No, it's certainly not.
You know, so how is so much of our medical community on board and okay with that because of the political influence? Like to me, that is both scary and fucking baffling.
Yeah, it is. I mean, it's why people need to get involved in the discussion and start understanding things. People, one of the great retorts from the left or the pro mandate folks is, well, you're not a doctor. I'm like, no, but I'm a rational human being and I can read data.
Yeah,
motherfucker. People keep, even during the interview with Rogan, Gupta kept referring back to this one study in Israel. It's the largest study ever done with 2.5 million fucking people, asshole, and the largest or in the greatest vaccinated population that exists.
Yeah,
so it's the high volume meritocracy that I always talk about. That's the way to test shit. And what we find is that your natural immunity is pretty goddamn good.
Yeah.
Which has been the case with every virus in the history of fucking viruses, man. It's, but, you know, that is what it is. But yeah, I don't like getting... I think when I say use power in its right way, I would say the standard for that is power to empower liberty. Mm-hmm. Right? Individual liberty and entrepreneurship are the ultimate inoculation against tyrannical bullshit. Those Agreed. Are the only two things combined together that will stop tyranny.
Yeah.
In my opinion.
And I want to loop crypto into that because I think that actually plays a role as well.
What's going to, if they try to fucking pass this bullshit where they're snooping around in people's bank accounts, then people are just going to, I'm telling you, it's going to be a Christmas or not a Christmas story. Which one is it? With Jimmy Stewart. What the fuck is it?
Miracle on
34th Street. People are going to pull their money out of banks. There's going to be the American financial banking system will fucking
collapse.
Gone.
Yeah, and that's the thing, you know. I mean, I think there's so many people that are blinded by their own arrogance in terms of their own success and the institutions, whether they're financial, political, et cetera, that are so quote unquote, you know, in place. Like nothing is fucking permanent that way. And to me, you know, not that it's likely, but I think any responsible adult in this country should at least entertain the prospect of what would you do if you woke up tomorrow morning and the U.S. dollar was worth fucking nothing.
Right.
You know, again, like, is it likely? No, but it's possible.
Yeah.
You know, and think about what you would do if that happened. You know, like that's an important thing to think about, I think. Yeah. And I think most people have no fucking concept of what the fuck they would do. You know, and I'm not saying go act like it's 1999 and, you know, you're digging a fucking Connex box fucking survival shelter under your house or anything, but I do think you should
maybe know where the shovels and Connex boxes
are. Like you should at least think about that. Anyway, I didn't mean to hijack list, but go ahead.
Those are all good points. So with the along the same lines as power, the fourth one is, as a leader, I will eat last. I think that is the hallmark of a good leader, right? That you arrive in a situation, whether it's calm or there's an emergency, and your first instinct is, once you, get your wits about you, is to make sure that everybody else is taken care of first. When I see somebody that outranks somebody else, whether it be in military, police, even social or financial class or whatever it is, taking care of themselves first, fuck that guy.
Yeah.
I got no time for that person.
With a big rubber dick.
Yeah. Five is, I'll put more into this country than I take out of it. That's a Boy Scout thing. That's what we used to teach young men. Is that not, don't leave it like you found it, leave it better than you fucking found it, right? That's how I was brought up. Even though my childhood was tumultuous, that's one of the things that was instilled in me from the very beginning.
Yeah. And you were a Boy Scout?
No. I just heard about it. I wasn't cool enough. I didn't want to wear that dumbass little uniform. Yeah.
No, I didn't do it either. I asked to do it. My dad was like, no, you're not doing it.
Now you can learn all that shit without dressing like a weirdo. Let's see. This sixth one is kind of a bastardization of an old JFK quote. And it says, I'll pay any price, bear any burden, meet any hardship, support any friend, oppose any foe in order to assure the survival and success of liberty. So this whole thing that's going on right now with mandates and shit, it's just 2 weeks. It's just a mask. It's just your business shutting down. It's just all this shit. At some point you got to kick just right in the fucking face.
Man. Yeah.
You know what I mean? And people, like I said before, they have no appetite for any kind of discomfort whatsoever. But discomfort is the key. It's the pathway. When you work out, it sucks, but then you get stronger. When you get sick, your immune system gets stronger. When you work long hours, you make more money. People that work 40 hours a week versus people that work 60 hours a week make the jump in pay between those two is exponential. It's like fucking 400% more pay that you make almost immediately if you start working more.
So I
think he said that during the containment phase of the Cold War, which is to say, Russia, we're gonna fucking fight you wherever you show up, so fuck off. But I think it applies in everyday life. Take a stand. Be the guy who walks by a piece of trash and picks it up because it's the right thing to do, and let other people see you doing it.
Yeah, I could be wrong. I think it was in reference to the Bay of Pigs time frame, but I feel the same way. And I'm stealing this from somebody. I don't even remember where it was, but it's the shopping cart. Or here in Texas, they call it a fucking buggy. the same kind of thing. Like, it's not a rule. Like, it's not, you're not breaking a law, but. Mm. Not putting it back says every fucking thing you need to know about somebody, and
you're making your fucking temporary discomfort somebody else's long-term problem. That's essentially what you're doing. You're a piece of shit. If you do that, honestly.
And one thing on that, I talk about this in the new book also is, we talk about the Constitution and I like how often you reference it. Cause I'm very like-minded that way. And then I think every politician should ask themselves that first is, before any quote unquote, new manufactured solution to a problem comes up, ask yourself, what does the Constitution say?
Right.
What direction does that give us to answer this fucking question or solve this problem?
That'd be a big problem for these guys, because the 9th and 10th Amendment says that the federal government's power is comically limited. And if it's not mentioned specifically here, it's not your purview.
Yeah. We're going to skip over that.
I think there's a lot of stuff that the framers couldn't have imagined, right? They wouldn't have thought that something as powerful as social media would have existed that could alter the course of human history and alter the course of an election fairly easily just by flipping a few switches, right?
Yeah.
So there's some stuff that we need to address, but I think the basic principles are there. People like to bring up how they weren't necessarily the best people. Ben Franklin was Flanderous and fucked everybody but his wife, apparently. Yeah. Thomas Jefferson owned quite a few slaves and fucked some of them as well, at least one. But the word that doesn't change the fact that the words they wrote were correct.
Right. And show me any individual in history that was perfect. Like,
Martin Luther King was fucking people all over the place too.
Who's that?
It's Martin Luther King. Yeah. He was banging pretty much everybody get his hands on back then.
He liked redheads, I guess. no bullshit. True story. He did. But,
That's funny.
On to the Constitution point in terms of your one of your bullet points there, or what do you call them? Your
principles.
Yeah, it's just... is that I, you know, I talk about a personal constitution as well, and it ties into your just, right? Is that same thing? Is it just like I think everybody should think about if the U.S. dollar is worth zero? I think you should also think about where is your fucking red line. Right. You know, because for all of the it's just this, it's just that. Like, is there a point where no, you know what? That's fucking too much. And if so, where the fuck is that? You know, because very few people think about that. They just continue to let one little thing erode to the next, to the next, to the next. The next thing you wake up and you are a fucking indentured servant to banks and government and fucking everything else. Yeah, and you have no fucking freedom and you don't even realize how you got there. And the reason people don't realize that is because it's always just and they don't have their own fucking breaking point.
Well, they don't have a plan in general. And a plan is, you know, a plan or an ideology untested is no plan at all. Right?
Yeah.
I mean, what did Eisenhower used to say? Planning is useless. Our plans are useless, but planning is indispensable, I believe is the phrase. We have to have these conversations internally with ourselves. Like, what am I willing to put up with? And then we need to have that conversation publicly in a way that, and if you're having that conversation publicly about where your red line is and, you know, the attorney general starts talking about you might be a domestic terrorist, it might be time to fucking tell that guy to go home and do something else.
Yeah.
Because he doesn't belong in that fucking position.
No, I agree. I mean, that's a big fucking deal. And I'm glad that people are making a big deal out of it, even on both sides of the fucking aisle politically. You know, but yeah, there needs to be a bigger highlight on that. And I think even if it's just internally, like, I think everybody has to think to themselves, like, at what point am I going to say, no, you know what? I'm not fucking doing that.
Yeah.
Like, do you even know? And if you don't, fucking choke yourself and then figure that out. Because you should know, you know. But, all right, what's your next
one? Number seven is, I will promote equality of opportunity, not outcome, particularly when I am in a position of power and wealth. This one I kind of rip a little bit of this from Jordan Peterson. He talks about the difference between equality and equity. The new word is equity, and equity means that everybody should get the same outcome, and that's fucking stupid. You know, that doesn't make any sense. There's no, the only forms of government that have ever even tried to do something like that were intentionally designed for power to swell to the top and everybody else to be equal, right? That's fuck that shit.
Yeah,
that's
it's the common person is worth X, and then there's the rest of them.
So what I mean when I say this is if you're a person out there that's doing well, find a way to help other people do well as well. And the general idea behind it is it's not one of those things where it's just about doing the right thing or it's just about helping other people and being empathetic. And then in this instance, it's not just about helping yourself. It's about boxing the government out. If you're pissed off at how big government has become, instead of making your neighbor rely on the government for something, get in the way, right? Obstruct, fuck the government, and take care of that situation yourself. Go find somebody and teach them how to do something, right? Yeah. That you know how to do or something like that. Start acting like you're part of a community and not like you're fucking subjects to a crown, because we don't do that shit here.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I hate to quote Game of Thrones, but we do not kneel in this fucking country.
You know, I've actually never seen a single episode of that fucking show.
You probably saved years of your life. Eight is I will reject divisiveness in all its forms because people who are trying to divide us are trying to conquer us. That's another one of those really old phrases. It's about 3,000 years old, divide and conquer.
Yeah.
And we see, pretty much everybody agrees that the media and politicians, and I'm talking, when I say everybody, I mean like 80% of the country, both liberal and conservative, think that everybody's trying to divide us all the time. And why have we not made that connection? That they're also trying to conquer. If somebody's trying to divide you, the only reason they're doing that is so they can fight you.
Yeah, it goes hand in hand.
Yeah.
Dividing and conquering.
And that's a big deal for me. I mean, I see this shit all the time about, to a callback to that dude that I interviewed the other day, Alec Ross, in his new book, The Raging 2020s. It's actually a really good book. He told me that I intentionally leave out the words Biden and Trump and Bush and Obama, Pelosi. I don't say anybody's names because as soon as you say those names, smart people get stupid, right? They start, they make excuses for Hunter Biden because they don't want it to tarnish Joe. right? Or they make excuses for all the stupid shit Trump says because they fucking believe in the populist movement and stuff like that. But that is nonsense.
Yeah.
Principles, not people. Like, we don't... We made such a big deal in this country about not having fucking kings, but every single 4 years we try to anoint one as some kind of fucking new savior of the universe. No, it's the facts and the principles that are going to save this country.
Yeah.
Number nine is, I will ensure justice come to those who deserve it, whether it be punishment or reward. And I think that's about accountability. You know what I mean? Like, if you're in large groups of people, and this is another thing about the bystander effect and this rapist piece of shit from the Congo. There is the bystander effect. The more people that are present, right, the less likely somebody is to intervene in a lot of cases. Now, that's not always true, but in a lot of cases, that's true. Be a fucking leader. Be a man. In the absence of leadership, your job is to lead. If you're a private in the army, right, and you have a sergeant and a staff sergeant ahead of you, and they're both dead, guess what? Your turn, motherfucker. Step up and start doing work. And that's something that we have to do in real life every single goddamn day. I'm not saying you have to be a Karen and walk around criticizing people all the time, but when you see stuff that is intrinsically wrong, say it out loud in public with everybody listening to you. Like, hey, I don't accept what you just did right there. Yeah. That's fucked up. Like, if some dude's talking down to his wife and calling her a piece of shit in public or whatever the fuck, like, hey, dude, no, you're not doing that in my fucking presence. You could take that shit home or somewhere else, but you're not doing it here.
Yeah. Well, and I think that, you know, back to the other principle that I think unfortunately invites people that are looking for a reason to be a nosy fuck is that same problem is that who's deciding what they need to get involved with versus not. I mean, one of the things I talk about in the book, like each chapter is basically prefaced with mind your own fucking business. You know, remove religion, emotion, and politics from your objectivity, or it's not objective, and then look at everything from that kind of viewpoint or lens,
right?
While also keeping yourself or holding yourself and your own party to the same standard as everybody else. Like, if you check those boxes before you enter in, you know, the problem solving phase, and if it's going into an argument or a discussion with somebody, the other two things that I think are key are is go in there with the intent to understand, not respond.
Right.
But then also go in there understanding, or at least, you know, being okay with and accepting the fact that you might actually be wrong. Mm-hmm. You know, so if you do all of those things and now you enter into the discussion with somebody, it's a lot harder to have the problems that you see on social media and the arguments and the divisiveness that takes place on both sides that way, because they're all influenced by those things. You got people who are clinging to either their politics or whatever religious beliefs that they just will not fucking compromise on. They're listening to respond or be right. They will not fucking accept the fact that they might actually be fucking wrong. And they're emotional about it. You know, you combine all of those things, and it's like, well, it's no wonder we don't fucking get along with anybody.
Yeah.
You know?
I mean, it's what we're... One of the solutions, and I agree with you, by the way, I think there are some intrinsic principles, and it's like Boondock Saints, right? Don't rape, don't steal, don't kill.
Yeah.
And I'm not talking about the Ten Commandments, because half of those are just about God fanning his own ego, apparently. But for the most part, there are some things I guess you can just operate with your right to swing your fist into my face. I think that's a good ground rule. And if somebody's being abusive towards another person, you got to stop that shit, right? That's how it's got to be. Now, on the understanding part, another thing Jordan Peterson talks about that he does in his clinical work when he's working with couples is, if there is a fundamental disagreement on something, he will make, like, let's say you and I disagree on
how much sex we're having.
Yeah, how much? Yeah, yeah. It doesn't matter what it is. He would make me explain your point back to you to your satisfaction. Right. So I would have to explain to you why you feel the way you do and what you feel specifically until you say, yes, that's exactly right. Otherwise, the conversation can't continue.
So you have to understand that other person's perspective.
You force people to fucking drop all the pretense and bullshit. and really understand it. And the other thing you're talking about going into the conversation, there's something called the principle of charity. Now, this is also 2,000 years old. It was written by a first century Jewish rabbi. And the principle of charity is you make it a point to take your opponent in an argument's statement at its best possible meaning, not its worst. Like, so what do you, if anybody rebuts with a phrase, so you're saying blah, 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 no, you're an asshole for even fucking talking like that in the first place.
So
like,
what you're telling me is...
So what you're telling me is you hate everybody and black people and blah, blah, blah. You hate gay people. Like, no, I didn't say any of that. I said what I fucking said, asshole.
Yeah.
So it's called the principle of charity. And it's something we should apply all the time, not just because it's the right thing to do as well, but because that's how you get the most accurate fucking information. Yeah. I mean, if you're a doctor and you're dealing with bad data, you're going to fucking get bad results, motherfucker. You know what I mean? That's just not how it works. If you're, do you remember, I don't remember what year it is. NASA on one of the first Mars landers, they programmed it in fucking meters instead of feet or vice versa or something. And it plowed like 60 feet into the fucking ground because they fucked it up. That is a good representation of how misunderstanding somebody can be tragic, especially when they need help and they're trying to get it and they don't know how to explain it. And you're taking them at their worst possible interpretation, sometimes on purpose, just to make your own fucking point.
Yeah. Yep.
It is very unethical to even think that way, but I don't know if people realize they do it half the time, to be honest.
Yeah. No. Yeah. I mean, for sure they don't. And I think we're all guilty of it, you know?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, that's the thing though. All these maxims and principles and blah, blah, blah. This is all infrastructure for daily life. This is stuff that has to become habitual. You have to apply these things every single day. It's like, that's why, is it McCraven that talks about making your bed or whatever the fuck? Yeah. That's what it's about. Ray Kerr is a piece of shit and he talks about making, like he sends me pictures from his hotel. Like, I just made my bed in my hotel. I'm like, shut the fuck up, dude. I haven't made my bed as an adult man and I don't plan to because unless I'm changing the sheets and shit, then I'll do it the first time.
That is one thing, and it has absolutely fuck all to do with McCraven. I'd say an episode in and of himself. I'd love to get his ass on here, but I always make my fucking bed. I cannot stand like that. For me, organization is a really big deal. Right. You know, whether it's in my office or, I mean, fucking any part of my life. Like if shit's not organized, A, I can't relax, and B, I'm far less productive.
No, I agree with that. But, I don't like clutter like that.
Yeah, for me, bed's same thing. It's like if. Like, you know, clothes on the floor or fucking bed unkempt or, you know, a wet towel. Like, it just, that shit drives me nuts. I mean, whether you call it OCD or whatever.
No,
I
mean, it's evolutionary, right? So we're pattern seeking creatures. So, and there's two types of patterns for us. One is food and pleasure, and the other one is threat. That's just how our brains work. And, you know, You sometimes we see stuff that's not really there, but that's the thing to mentally prepare yourself throughout the day. Carl Sagan used to say, it's far better to grasp reality as it is than persist in delusion, no matter how gratifying the delusion is. And reality is reality. It's not changing for anybody. You know what I mean? You better fucking get on board with it and adjust to it. Like we were talking about diet earlier, you probably don't want to use the same diet that somebody else does. There's a very small chance, I guess, that you would have the same dietary needs based on your fucking personal evolution, but it's not a big chance.
Yeah.
I mean, there's going to be some similarities if you're the same, same ethnicity and shit like that, but there are huge differences in the stuff people need that develop in childhood. Maybe you were deficient in something and now your body doesn't produce enough of it naturally, so you crave it more, for example. Shit like that happens all the time. But anyways, that was a bit of a tangent. Number 10 is I'll place virtue above commerce. People like LeBron James is a good example of this shit. And now Enes Kanter from the, I don't know if you follow sports much.
Not much, but I mean, I would say well-read enough on him getting involved in a lot of things. It seems like he has no business getting involved in. But
Yeah. Well, I mean, so Daryl Morey was the general manager of the Houston Rockets at the time. I think it was 2019. And he said something that, I don't remember what the phrase or quote or whatever the fuck was, but it was something pro Hong Kong democracy.
Yeah.
And LeBron James responded after China got fucking pissed because they own half the NBA.
Yeah.
LeBron said, yeah, he just didn't know what he was talking about. He didn't take the time to educate himself, and there could be consequences from that, like financial consequences. And like he started, the first thing he said was financial consequences. So I knew he was a piece of shit right there.
Yeah.
But just the premise that he's operating from in the first place is completely wrong. Daryl Morey, maybe he doesn't know enough about China. I don't know the man, honestly. But I do know that China's currently operating about 1,400 concentration camps filled with Uyghur Muslims. And the worst thing that happens to them isn't death. You know what I mean? It's bad there. These people are fucking evil. Yeah. I don't mean Chinese people are evil. I mean the government of China is fucking evil.
Yeah.
And demonstrably so.
Yeah.
So when you tell somebody that they don't know what they're talking about, when they're saying maybe somebody should fucking break off from that evil bullshit, and your primary motivation, even in your own statement, is financial, then you are a piece of garbage,
mm-hmm.
right? That's I don't think there's any room for interpretation there. Although, I mean, he's done a lot of stuff for kids in inner cities with the schools and stuff he's built. That's cool.
Yeah.
But I feel like he's, just based on all the other evidence I've seen, it appears as though he's doing that because he thinks he should.
Yeah.
Because when it comes down to actually losing money, he's not willing to do that.
Yeah.
And you have, there has to be some pain, right?
Yeah.
If you're sacrificing and there's no pain, you're not sacrificing. You're just glorifying yourself.
Yeah, for sure. I think that's one of the hard parts of, you know, again, I think it's principle six, you know, is that he probably thinks he's doing the right thing. And there's also other people that think he's doing the right thing. And I think where it's hard for anybody, and I'll even say us included, to navigate that is that simple principle of, if you think something is right, you know, let's say it's even on this show, like I feel very strongly about X, and X is socially fucking dicey. And so I don't talk about X because, well, I don't want to get canceled. Like,
yeah.
you know,
yeah.
so to me, that's kind of the same thing, unfortunately, you know, is that we're all a little guilty of that, I think, in that, like, are you going to hear me say every single fucking thing that you'd hear me say in my house? No, it's not far off. I'll tell you that. Like, I don't censor fucking much, you know, but I think that's one of the hard parts about this cancel culture that has created people that tread water in that space all the fucking time, is that they're constantly putting commerce and money above virtue. Where the hard part is again, is what's virtuous to me may be sacrilege to somebody else. And that's the hard part, I think, with all of it, is that everybody, I mean, again, like, look at human history. You know, there were portions of the Nazi party that thought they were doing the right fucking thing.
Sure.
You know,
yeah, but I mean, like, look, there's something to be said for personal experience, but, and we can have that conversation if somebody wants to debate whether or not what they're doing is placing virtue over commerce. I think that there can be a reasonable conversation about that, and we can determine. There's no telling a guy to stop promoting democracy in a country that's authoritarian because you worry about your own financial loss. I don't think there's a whole lot of room for debate on that, or Nazism either, right? There are some, like, should we be in Afghanistan right now, right? Are we putting commerce, that is to say, we spent a fuck ton of money over there and we don't want to do that anymore, right? Or whatever the fuck else, over virtue, which is to help people that need help, and they clearly need help. But the reality of that situation is you cannot fucking give somebody democracy. They have to take it for themselves.
Yeah.
They have to take liberty.
Yeah. I mean, we've seen that in almost every country that we've had involvement in the Middle East.
60 years.
Yeah. I mean, even here recently in the last, say, 10 years, I mean, the Arab Spring starting in Egypt and then moving over to Libya and Syria and fucking Iraq and Afghanistan. I mean, they're all examples of the same whore in a different fucking dress of the exact same thing.
Yeah.
Is that, you know, you can't just set a fucking way of life and government.
No, teach a man to fish thing. Like, hey, here's how to do it. Good luck.
Yeah.
Right. You got to do it yourself. There's no version of any Middle Eastern country or any Asian country where white faces roll in there, liberate everybody, and then teach them how to govern and leave. That will never, ever work. And that's what actually... That's what George W. Bush ran on in 2000. If you remember that, no nation building.
Yeah.
For that exact reason, because you can't force people into democracy.
Yeah. Nor should you. I mean, no different than, like, I mean, imagine if, playing devil's advocate here, imagine China decides that they're going to build an Air Force base 19 miles south of fucking Tijuana.
Yeah.
And they're looking at us like, you know, this whole Judeo-Christian based democracy thing isn't really fitting our fucking lifestyle, isn't really our jam. So we're gonna go ahead and topple your fucking government and institute a Buddhist based communist government. You're welcome. Right. You know, like, you know, goddamn good and well, you and I'd have masks on running around shooting at them. Like,
for
100% sure. 100%, so
yeah.
So you know, there is something to that, and I think, you know, this is one of the hard part with that. I think is that, you know, it's the those who forget history are doomed to repeat it. Like, we haven't forgotten it. Like, we're just burying our goddamn head in the sand.
Yeah.
Over and over and over and over on a lesson we've already learned how many fucking times.
Well, I think a lot of people still are in the position that you were talking about earlier, which is, where is the red line? Because I'm not sure I know the answer to that all the time. Like, yeah. And I know for myself, once things start affecting me personally, it's time to act. But I think that probably isn't the best way to think about that, because you and I have had the opportunity, I guess, if you want to classify it that way, to see what real bad shit looks like, and then to learn how to defeat that bad shit. And you do have some responsibility to people who haven't seen it and aren't capable of doing it, right?
Yeah.
I don't know where that kicks in, to be honest. It's something that people that watch our shows ask me all the time, and frankly, I don't know the answer to it. I think maybe we'll know it when we see it, but that hasn't worked out in history very many times. I mean, there's a famous interview with a Czech woman that survived the Holocaust, and she goes, somebody asked her, like, how did you guys let this fucking happen? Like, why didn't somebody do something? And she goes, well, it didn't happen all at once. It was like one thing. It was just until it was just too goddamn much.
Yeah. It's what you're saying now. It's just until it doesn't matter if you fight back.
Right.
You know,
I mean, it's that old poem, right? First they came for the socialists, and I wasn't a socialist, so I didn't say anything. Then they came for the trade unions. I wasn't a trade unionist, so I didn't say anything. Then they came for the Jews, and I wasn't a Jew, and I didn't stand up. And then when they came for me, there was nobody fucking left to stand up.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And I don't want us to get to that point. You know damn well that if anything is happening like that, and it seems like the institutions that protect us are under a violent attack, both from internal and external sources, the last people they're going to come for is us, right? Because they don't want to have that fight until everybody else is on their side. And then it's going to be too late for all those people.
Yeah.
Right. I mean, it's not, we can fight whenever. That's not going to be the problem.
Yeah.
I don't want to be in a situation where I'm in an echo chamber where I'm sitting around thinking about myself and how comfortable I am. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Because, like, I'm not worried about that because I'm trained and I've got plenty of guns and blah, blah, blah. But what about everybody else? You know what I mean? This is a country. This country didn't start with a bunch of professional soldiers. It started with fucking farmers picking up muskets and shit.
That became professional soldiers overnight.
I mean, that was probably one of the biggest examples of on-the-job training in the history of human beings. And to that point, the last one, and this is a working list too. We change stuff sometimes. And I go back and listen to conversations I have. I post these things and ask people to talk about it because I want to develop it into something that means stuff. It's not just about the single sentence. It's about the conversation behind it, right?
Yeah.
And the last one is I'll live a life worth dying for. And I don't know. That sounds kind of vague, but I want people to think about what that means to them. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like what you were saying earlier, my buddies, wherever they happen to be, if there's an afterlife, what are they thinking? What would they expect of me right now? And how could I honor their sacrifice? You should be thinking about that shit.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. I mean, that should drive every fucking day, honestly, because anybody with survivor's guilt, or even if you don't, you know, the fact is that if they're in that position, that should be something that drives, what your purpose is and what fuels you.
And that's a really good way just to think about things in general. Like what would Jefferson, who, by the way, this is I love the framers of the Constitution because of how everybody thinks, or people who aren't very well educated on the subject think that it was just a bunch of dudes who agreed with each other who got together and fucking started a country. Not even close. They fucking hated each other.
And especially when you look what happened to, you know, almost everybody that signed the fucking those documents. Yeah. Like what happened to them afterwards is pretty fucking terrible.
Yeah.
Like they, I mean, you talk about taking one for the fucking team. Those dudes fucking sacrificed everything.
Yeah, and it's hard. Like a lot of people have trouble marrying what they said and what they did. So Jefferson wrote the documents that he wrote, that all men are created equal, right? That life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness is the main objective. Like, that should be guaranteed. And the only way to guarantee it, if you skip over to the Federalist Papers, is by us pooling our collective military might and fighting any external aggressor and shit like that. But Thomas Jefferson and Alexander Hamilton hated each other. They hated each other. Those two parties hated each other so much so that when Thomas Jefferson was vice president under John Adams, he left. He left. He went back home and stayed there until he won the next election. You know what I mean? Yeah. So it wasn't all this. And to marry up, Jefferson routinely would say in public that slavery was an abomination, right?
Yeah.
Despite currently owning slaves. Now, people have a problem with that. They think maybe he was as full of shit. This comes back to this conversation of constantly moving the goalposts. You have to understand somebody where they're standing right now. And that's what makes a really good counselor or PTSD professional or suicide intervention person is, like, I've been there. I know what it feels like. There's an old story. The first time I think it's older than this, but I think the first time I ever heard it was on that show, The West Wing, in like 2002 or some shit. But it tells the story of a man trapped in a well. And he falls down in this well, and a doctor comes by. He's like, "Hey, doc, I'm in a well. Can you help me out?" He goes, "Oh, yeah." And he writes him a prescription and throws it down. And then a religious guy comes by, and he's like, hey, priest, whatever the fuck, can you help me out? I'm stuck in this well." And he goes, "Yeah, I'll say a prayer with you." And he says a prayer and leaves. And his buddy comes by, and he goes, "Hey, dude, what the fuck? Help me out." So his buddy jumps down in the hole. And he's like, "What the fuck are you doing? Now we're both stuck down here." And he goes, "Yeah, but I've been here before, and I know the way out." And that's the challenge that every one of us should think about every single day. All these problems that people are having, navigating all these issues, you've been there, and you know how to get the fuck out. And you better start telling other people, because it's just going to be you guys left.
Yeah,
you know what I mean? Like, the whole purpose of this country is the fucking... is the collective will of those who persist in liberty.
Yeah.
Right? Like, we might disagree on some stuff and blah, 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 but in general, mind your own fucking business, right? Yeah. And if somebody needs help, help them. Like, this, a lot of folks these days that are on this mind your own business side of the camp will very frequently say that they just want to be left alone, and they will appeal back to, like, the 1840s or some shit like that, right? And they're right to a lot of to some degree, but in the 1840s, in the absence of any kind of real effective law enforcement, or even if you're out west, the federal government didn't have a great reach out there. Somebody shows up and starts fucking murdering your cows or stealing your horses, and you don't fucking go after them alone. You go to your neighbors and you posse up and you go hunt down this dude and kill that motherfucker. Right? That's how it worked. And you didn't have to persuade the other men to do that. They all knew that that was their responsibility.
Yeah.
So that, to me, is what America is. It's about, we all agree that we want to fucking go about our own lives, but we also recognize that there's some level of effort that each one of us has to put in to make that possible.
Yeah.
And if you're not putting in your level of effort, you don't deserve the comfort.
Yeah. No, I agree. I mean, and you know, to me, that prospect, I think, is the separation of black and white, or removes the gray area of where do you draw that line of, you know, being nosy versus, you know, whatever, is that, you know, when something is pretty universally accepted as being, you know, fucked up and wrong, especially if it's endangering or theft or, you know, violence, hurting, you know, other people, like, that's pretty clear cut. Then you band together and you don't stand for it. I mean, that seems like it should be pretty common sense, but I mean, I think the situation that happened on the train the other day tells you that it isn't, unfortunately.
No, that's cultural decay is what that is. I mean, that's simply what it is. I mean, you see, this week you've seen the two types of human beings that exist in America.
Yeah.
You've seen the type, well, I mean, multiple, but the two types of people that fucking, how they handle responsibility.
Yeah.
Right? That doesn't necessarily affect them.
Yeah.
The first person or first group of people stood around and watched while a woman got brutalized and raped for 40 fucking minutes. And the Marine did what Marines do.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And who, ask yourself who you want to be.
Yeah.
Right. If you want to feel good about yourself and all, if that social currency matters to you, stop being a fucking victim.
Yeah.
Stop participating in the outrage Olympics. stop having oppression FOMO.
Yeah.
Right? And start doing shit to fucking help people.
Well, I think on top of that too, which is really key, is not only, you know, pick which one you want to be, also pick which one you would want around you. You know, because if you're the only one that way, well, then that's going to be hard to have a fucking collective society that's built right.
Yeah, and that's what I mean when I say ensure justice comes to people who deserve it, whether it's punishment or reward. I don't mean like take them to court or arrest them or beat them up or any of that shit like that. But those little things like, hey, I don't accept what you just did. Or, hey, you know what? You did a really good job right there. We do a lot of fucking tearing down in this country, and rightfully so. There's a lot of institutions that need to be torn the fuck down. But we don't do a lot of building up. I mean, how many people show up to support something when the guy does the right thing versus somebody who shows up to protest when he does the wrong thing?
Yeah. And to that point, absolutely. It's like, yeah, let's tear all this down. Now what? Yeah. Fuck, I don't know. I didn't think about that. I mean, we learned that lesson in Iraq in a lot of ways, right?
Yeah. Well, I mean, there's a way we can give back right now, and that's apparently to go eat at In-N-Out. Yeah. Because they're telling people to go fuck themselves left and right. And I think that is the other important part. That is, which one is it? Number 7. I'll promote equality of opportunity, but the last part, particularly when I'm in a position of power and wealth. In-N-Out knows goddamn well that California cannot beat them. In-N-Out is an institution. That's like, there's no fucking chance that in any battle that's fought in the public court is going to win, or that California is going to beat In-N-Out. In-N-Out is In-N-Out, right? They know that they have that power, and that's why they're taking this stand. Yeah. That's the only reason they're doing it. It's not because they're more necessarily more moral or ethical than anybody else, because there's a lot of places out there that wish they could do this, and they just don't have the ability to, because they're going to lose everything.
Yeah.
In-N-Out knows, like, hey, I'm the fucking big dude around here. You can go fuck yourself.
Yeah.
And I think organizations like that have been like that have been pretty pro populist in the past, like Target, for example, pays its employees they pay their employees, I think, about 40% more than Walmart employees, and Target makes 6 times more per employee than Walmart does. Like, there's an immediate benefit to that kind of fucking behavior.
Yeah.
It's almost like Nash's equilibrium theory, but we're not going to go into all that horse shit. But it's time for some of these bigger organizations that aren't politically motivated to say, this isn't about politics. We're just not your fucking police force, dude.
Yeah.
Like, we're not going to let you circumvent the process of having Congress vote on laws and stamp their name to it and say, I did this because of me.
Right. Yeah.
And use regulation behind the scenes to fucking force people to do shit they don't want to do.
Yeah. No, yeah, I agree. I mean, I think that's the last ditch effort, to keep it turning into a totalitarian type of almost regime-like government is that that's the one fucking gatekeeper, because they're big enough, wealthy enough, powerful enough to actually stop the government from doing it if they just stop fucking doing what they tell them.
Yeah, and it's when I see any kind of threat to something that is intrinsic to our survival, like food, stuff we need to stay alive, or in some cases ammunition, right?
Yeah.
Hornady, there's a letter circulating from their CEO it's their namesake. Like, he bears the same name. I think it's John Hornady. Apparently they're going to succumb to the 100 employees or more thing and tell people to get vaccinated. Like, no, dude.
Yeah. It's crazy.
No, you're one of the primary manufacturers of ammunition domestically right now. It's something that that was a huge fucking mistake. I don't know what they're thinking over there. Like, did they really think that this crowd that buys all their product is
especially with their customer base, but to me, that's still putting, you know, commerce over virtue. I mean, to me, irrespective of what it does for you or doesn't do for you, I mean, I think that's part of the problem is, like, well, if it's good for business, then fuck it either way, whether it's virtuous or not. Like, and that's the problem, is they're not looking at it from a, is this the right thing to do standpoint, nor are they looking at it from a business standpoint. But it's baffling for sure. Those are great principles. I appreciate you sharing them. A couple of things I just wanted to, you know, from a hotbed issue standpoint, I know you're big into sports.
Mm-hmm.
Steroids in sports, what's your take on them?
I want to see the ball hit as far as fucking possible. That's my take.
I want to see the jaw punched as hard as possible.
Yeah, dude, as long as the playing field is level, I don't give a shit.
Yeah.
Well, why would anyone care? Like, there's some purity to the game. Ty Cobb's in the Hall of Fame, and he pulled a gun on a fucking umpire one time, and he was the biggest racist piece of shit of all time.
I agree. And that similarly to that, it's like, where do you draw the line even on that? It's like, well, if this team has way more money, yeah, they have salary caps, but what about, like, hiring the best nutritionists? Or it's like, at what point do you say this is an advantage versus not? And I agree, like, let everything be okay, and then it's just whoever's the best at utilizing all their resources.
There's actually somebody who did a really fun wrote a really fun article on this after the whole Lance Armstrong thing, right? And there's this Norwegian cross-country skier whose blood is oxygenated to a level, and his recovery level is such that he gets the same result that Lance Armstrong, he gets the same result naturally. He just had, that's genetic.
Like, he's on EPO all the time.
Yes, that he's on EPO all the time, right? So should he be disallowed just because it happened naturally?
Yeah.
Like, taking the step to make yourself better. This is why science exists, is to make us, like, it's fine to get polio vaccines so we don't get that, but not okay to take fucking TRT?
Yeah.
The fuck, especially when, I don't know if your audience knows this, this is a big fucking deal that every adult man in this country should know. Over the last 25 years, the average adult male's testosterone levels dropped by 40%.
Yeah.
40%, right? Every one of you should be on TRT, probably, if you're over 27, probably, at this point. It used to be like 32, 33. Now it's like 27. You should be taking testosterone. You should probably be taking stuff like Sermorlin as well that helps you produce more natural HGH. Why wouldn't you do that?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, why not make yourself fitter and healthier?
Yeah. I mean, and especially in the military where, dude, your fucking life's on the line.
Yeah.
Like, that is...
Well, a good team doc has got you all squared up, right?
Yeah. Well, I mean, I can only speak from when I was in where that was not the case.
No, I wasn't.
You know, I mean, I got...
You have to do some stuff behind the scenes. I don't know. Yeah. Why the fuck are tier one or two operators not provided with this shit?
Yeah, it's crazy. I mean, and monitored and make sure it's done safe, because there is, just like with most things, there's a right way and a wrong way to do everything.
But it's not a Captain America fucking serum. It's just, it's not even amplifying your natural shit. It is reversing what hormones and food and plastics have done to us over the last 50 years or so.
Yeah. Well, and the plastics things I know is huge, and the, you know, different chemicals and things that are in almost every, like, shampoo and conditioner and lotion. Yeah. And I mean, but, on top of that also is the from a performance standpoint, so often people are like, oh, that fucking guy's on steroids. Like, that dude still works his fucking ass off.
Yeah,
you know, like, he's maximizing. I
mean, everybody was on steroids in baseball from like the mid 80s until 2004 or so.
Yeah.
And only one of them did what Barry Bonds did.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Only one of them did what Mark McGwire and Sosa did and all this other stuff. Yeah. So I don't want to hear that shit.
Yeah. I mean, it gets scapegoated and I think unnecessarily, but no, I
just give everybody the same shit.
Yeah.
And see what happens.
Or like, just
don't
let
you want the best performance?
Yeah. Just let everybody do whatever the fuck they want. And then again, it's who can utilize resources at their disposal the best.
I think that's called a meritocracy.
Yeah. Now we're going to regulate everything. The next thing I wanted to ask, taking a knee / politics in sports, taking a knee during the anthem.
You know, I understand why it would offend people, especially when it comes from somebody that seems to be disingenuous. Right. I mean, a lot of people forget that it was a special forces operator that
Nate
Boyer that told him to do that, because he thought sitting down was disrespectful, but that kneeling is something that we do or a lot of people do during wakes or whatever fucking ceremonies, when your buddy's kit's all up on the cross or whatever the fuck, and you do the final call and then the whatever music plays and people take a knee and shit. That's, I think that's what he was kind of alluding to. But I think that if you really believe that that's as big of an issue as it is, and the data doesn't bear that out, by the way, the FBI statistics don't bear out that black people are under constant assault by police. It's just not true. But if you do believe that, and you do see, because there is some stuff that's systemic that disproportionately affects black people, like vaccine mandates, for example, especially in New York, about 65% of black people are not going to get vaccinated up there, which means they're now excluded from public life entirely. Yeah. Right?
But it's not racist, because it's a Democrat policy.
It's just segregation with more steps. That's all it is.
Under a different name.
Yeah. So there's certainly stuff that needs to be fixed and you can call attention to it, but if ultimately it is a cultural insurgency, and the second step of an insurgency is to gain patronage, right? It wasn't an armed revolution that ended slavery in this country, right? It was white dudes voting in Congress on the 14th Amendment, 13th, 14th Amendment. That's what actually happened. And I'm not saying that white people saved black people from slavery. I'm saying that convince people the right way that your point is true, right? That it's correct, and they will fucking help you, right? And maybe I understand the anger, right? I get it. Especially people that have been told by the government we're helping you for all this time, and it's they've experienced instead 30% or so of their population being imprisoned, in private prisons, by the way,
yeah,
that have contracts with the federal and state governments, but also generational poverty. I understand why people would be mad about that. I understand why about 80% of all wealth in this country is passed from one generation to the next, and about $1 trillion, right? Half of the wealth that you would expect from the population size of the black community was robbed from them and never given back because of slavery. Got it. 100%, that's all true, and that's something that needs to be dealt with. You're not going to deal with it by fucking offending deeply the people who can help you fix it. It just won't work. And I'm not saying, I don't want to get into the business of telling people how, when, where, and why to protest. Like, do whatever the fuck you want. It's a free country. But I want you to win, because our country is stronger when everybody is on the same fucking plane, right?
Yeah.
There's no, if there's somebody in your team that feels ostracized for some reason, your team is fucking broken.
Yeah.
It does not work.
Yeah.
And that's where we are right now. So I want that shit to get fixed. But it doesn't take, yeah, anybody that's studied insurgencies knows exactly how this fucking plays out.
Yeah.
Right. And I want you to win. That's it.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, my take, this is one of those things where my perspective has shifted. And I use that as an example in the book on, going into a conversation with the prospect that you might be wrong or be willing to have your mind changed. Is at first I was fucking pissed, I saw it, I was angry. And I thought like, fuck that shouldn't be allowed, et cetera. And, after not too long of a time of calming the fuck down, removing emotion from my stance on it, I looked at it very simply is that, to me, at the end of the day, every NFL team is a company, or the NFL is a company. Every NFL team is a business. Mm-hmm. And they should be allowed to allow their business to be run how they see fit.
Right.
And if that's how they think it should be run, then they ought to be allowed to do it, whether it fucking twist my panties or not. They ought to be able to.
And if they're taking something tangible away from you, that's a different story, but that's not what's happening.
Yeah, they're not.
They're affecting you emotionally, basically.
Yeah, and it should not be illegal.
Right.
I don't have to like it, and that's where, capitalism can play a huge role in that you can vote with your wallet and just not watch if you don't like it. No different than if you're against abortion, you just don't get one.
Yeah.
Or if you don't like drugs, don't fucking do them. You don't like guns, don't buy one.
Right.
And that's, I think pretty consistent throughout most of my perspectives on, just about everything. But I like to get people's perspective on it. And I like to use that as an example of realizing when you're making a mistake, interjecting visceral emotion and letting that drive how you view or perceive something and how it can be ultimately wrong. And usually is,
it usually is. Yeah.
You're
not going to get, the problem that when people ask a question like that, or when they're asking themselves that question, I think they've, because of just the way we've evolved through the social media period, they want a fucking 2-3 sentence answer to that question that solves everything. And that's not fucking how life works.
Yeah.
Man.
Not how real life works.
It doesn't work that way. And it's not going to. So yeah, I mean, if somebody, I don't want to sound like I'm diminishing their plight or their effort or anything like that, but this is the same, like if a toddler is throwing a fit, you can try to calm them down, but ultimately you're going to have to solve the fucking problem, right? Like people make, and this is one of the things that NLK used to say, is that the riots are the voice of the unheard, right? If people feel unheard, they're going to make a lot of noise, and you at some point have to decide to forget about the tantrum and figure out what the fuck's wrong and see if it's really wrong or if they're just complaining, and then try to fix it if it is wrong.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Well, yeah, and I think this, where that I'll call it a perception because again, the data doesn't back it up. Right. And that's really the benchmark.
About the police thing. Yeah.
The data shows very clearly that is just not the fucking case.
Right.
And that's a classic example of again, it's overwhelmingly liberal media that is conditioning people to think and feel a certain way about something right. that's not accurate. And that's really the entire premise of my new book is, here are the dozen fucking things that are from a data standpoint impacting our country the most negatively, mm-hmm.
And it's not white supremacy, by the way, that's nonsense. Yeah. I mean, that's even the fucking, was it Milley that said that white supremacy is one of the biggest
domestic threat to our fucking
Austin, General Austin said it was COVID.
Yeah, no, it's yeah. I mean, climate change.
The most healthy, biggest national and athletic group of human beings on Earth.
Yeah,
yeah. I mean, it's silly, but you do have to. People still have to be primed to believe something like that. Like, you're not going to come tell a happy person that X, Y, and Z is wrong and have them believe you.
Yeah,
like they have to be. There has to be some underlying issue happening already. They feel excluded from society, or they don't feel like they have the same shit. And sometimes it's going to be a case of actually, you do. Here's how to do it, which is what I was talking about before. Teach people how to fucking fish, goddamn it. And the other part is convince them if they're wrong about that. But like, yeah, you're wrong about this, but I'm not just going to fucking dance on your fucking grave now. I'm not going to spike the football. I'm going to say, hey, you're wrong, but here's the right answer. Come here and I'll fucking show you.
Yeah, don't just worry about the win.
Yeah, why? What do you win when you win an argument? You don't win shit.
Yeah.
Like, well, you feel good? Like, fuck you, man. Yeah. I don't care about that shit.
No, I agree. And I think, the media, I think, is largely at fault in that. And that, when you look at what they focus on, we were talking about this the other day, the Gabby Petito case. Mm. It's like how many fucking tens of thousands of people go missing in this country every year? And I mean, hundreds of thousands, and this particular case is picked. But same thing, like how many people are shot and killed every day.
A lot more in South Chicago than by any police.
Yeah. I mean, like more.
One year in South Chicago shootings is worth, 50 years of police shootings?
I mean, it's way more than that. I mean, it's fucking one year in Chicago is more dangerous than the entire campaign in Afghanistan.
Jesus.
I mean, it's like 6,000 fucking people. I mean, it's crazy. Overwhelmingly, which are black,
Because that's where they fucking live. And that's another thing about this whole gun goddamn debate that I've just had enough of. First of all, let's look at these FBI statistics. 67% of the deaths are suicide. Yeah. So don't tell me when the fucking vast majority are suicides that it's not a mental health issue primarily, right?
Yeah.
First. Second, of the remainder, the vast majority, 69%, are with handguns, not rifles, assault rifles, whatever the fuck that means, is less than 2%.
More people are murdered with knives than rifles, period.
Hammers, yeah. blunt instruments. Yeah. Yeah. So if people really cared about gun violence, all these fucking dum-dums in politics and all these activists and shit would be marching the streets of Chicago right now, trying to get those handguns back from people who purchased them illegally.
Yeah.
You know what the percentage of gun crimes committed with legally purchased handguns is? Because it's not much.
Yeah, it's fucking a fraction of. Yes. Of
it's the like 3%.
Yeah.
So it's you can't legislate your way out of that.
Yeah.
Because the problem isn't the law. The laws already exist to prevent that. You can't do it that way. So accept that as reality, and then move on and actually fix the problem. Because we should probably look into fixing that, right? Yeah. God damn.
Yeah. Well, and I'm a proponent of. Going back to the mental health thing, that gets brought up a lot, right? Even that, I think, is a little disingenuous or misleading, or there's an agenda to it, right? Is that, just saying, oh, it's a mental health thing. Well, most people say, okay, how do we address that? Like, even that, I think, is very misguided, and that what that usually is big pharma and a lot of money.
Yeah, exactly.
It's like, they need to go into these institutions and be prescribed 19 different medications. No. Like, people need to stop eating shit that isn't meant to be eaten. Yeah. You need to stop smearing products all over your body that are fucking poisonous, and living in stressful and environmentally toxic environments that are making people fucking crazy.
Yeah, and on the whole, the gun debate is very nuanced. I like the way, Colleen Noir does a good job of fucking representing that side in public. But I'll say this, I think everybody... that's listening to this right now probably knows at least one person that shouldn't own a gun.
Yeah.
But that doesn't mean that we need to get the government involved in saying who can and can't. And the whole red flag thing. I understand why somebody would think about that. Like, hey, if we've got this information that says that this person is statistically likely to do something violent with a gun, what is our responsibility exactly now that we have that information? But giving the government power to adjudicate that issue is a fucking complete non-starter.
Yeah,
absolutely not. We've seen what they do. We've seen what governments do in general, but we've seen what our government does when they feel like they have power over us. Fuck that shit.
And I would say especially with guns, right?
Yeah.
Is that because here's the deal, is that that person, right? If let's say person X, or let's say it's you, right? Let's say that me and you know, a handful of people that know you well enough all kind of have this sneaking suspicion like, you know, I really don't think Dan should have a fucking gun. Like,
right,
he's that fucked up and unstable to where I don't trust this dude with a gun. I don't want him renting a car. I don't want him being able to go to a fucking kid's playground.
It's time for an intervention of some sort.
Yeah, like, you shouldn't be allowed to buy booze. Like, and we already have that in that, like, if you're that big of a fucking problem, you get institutionalized.
Correct,
you know? So what is there to even fucking talk about on the transverse when you give the government the authority and the autonomy and the flexibility and power to take fucking guns away? Now you remove the great equalizer of everybody.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, Dave Chappelle said it best, right? The First Amendment exists so we have the right to say what we want, and the Second Amendment exists in case that first one doesn't work out.
Yeah, I mean, the Second Amendment exists to provide the First Amendment. I mean, you don't have the first without the second. So I mean,
it's just the government cannot be trusted to handle these things, and that's it goes back to that other point I made, like, box the government out. If you see, instead of, there's a very clear, like, every situation is different, and look, there's going to be gun violence if guns exist. If there's going to be violence if guns exist or they don't, check fucking England with getting their fucking
the government official got stabbed to death.
Member of Congress got stabbed to death in broad daylight. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I mean, there's gonna be violence if humans exist.
Yeah,
period.
Yeah, for sure. Know? But we can mitigate some of the things you could do. Like, you can't force somebody to remove themselves from a situation that they don't want to remove themselves from. You can't do it. In the same way, you can't deal with a drug addict until they're ready to be dealt with. And I apply that same logic to nation building. You can't force somebody into democracy any more than you can force a druggie to stop doing drugs until they're ready to stop.
Yeah.
Right.
Amen.
But there's gotta be some, like, there's stuff you could do. You could pay attention, first of all, which I think is a good idea. Mind your own business, but pay attention. Right?
Yeah.
Minding your own business doesn't mean put your head in the sand.
Yeah.
And if you know, you see somebody that can't protect themselves, that might be in danger because of that wild ass person, try to coax them out of that situation the same way that you would do in a hostage negotiation or anything like that. Right.
Yeah.
There's a lot of stuff you can do that doesn't involve the government, because, you know, when you allow the government to come in and make laws, you can't think of it from the perspective of what you need right now. You think about what could a bad actor in government do to weaponize this law right now.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? That should be the caveat to any fucking thing that ever gets put in any legal book.
That, and I think understand the premise that whatever you hand over to them isn't coming back.
Yeah,
it's not coming back.
Yeah.
So
not ever.
Yeah. So, you know, think about that. Last question I have before I open the floor up to you is President fucking Dan. What do you do?
That's a good question. I mean, I think we need to sincerely ask ourselves if our form of democracy is scalable at this level, right? Does giving people liberty, and I operate from the premise that liberty is the ultimate. I don't care about, like, I don't get romantic about maintaining all 50 states or even the name of the country. None of that shit matters. What matters is liberty ultimately to me, right? Individual liberty. So I wonder if we're at that point in the marriage that it's time to fucking call it quits. And I don't mean 50 individual states, and I don't mean civil war and that stupid bullshit. I mean, I think we need to have a grown-up conversation about do we even want to be the United States anymore? I think McConaughey said it on somebody's show recently even. It's like, do we even want to be together anymore? Are we even willing to have a conversation? Do people who agree with what's happening in California, New York, want to be associated with what's happening in Texas? And if the answer is no, then we've got a bit of an issue, right? I don't know what I would do as president. I mean, the president doesn't really have that much power, to be honest. I mean, you can influence the executive branch, but that's the you can see in how we developed and designed our government how little human beings can be trusted on their own, right? That's even in small groups, we're like, no, they still can't be trusted to maintain each other. We need separate levels of government to keep an eye on each other, and then we need the people armed to keep an eye on them.
Mm-hmm.
So I think we need to have a real conversation about if it's time to go to something more akin to the EU, where we have separate states that operate with the same currency and the same military, you know what I mean? Which would be interesting, because you have to do a lot of, there's a lot of gymnastics you have to do there legally. You have to, there's a lot of trade deals that would be affected. There's a lot of temporary discomfort that would happen. And you have to figure out what it means to have a military at that point. Like, what's our military for?
Yeah.
Are we still fighting foreign wars like that, or are we just sticking at home until it's time to fuck shit up? You know what I mean? I just don't know. I'm not saying that that's the solution necessarily, but I think that's the one conversation that people are really afraid to have right now because of what it means. It means that's frightening for your country to break up like that, right?
Yeah. No, I mean, to me, I'm willing to have fucking any conversation, honestly. My take in hearing that, it would just be like, what's the upside? You know, because it's like, okay, we're broken up now.
Mm.
Okay. We still hate each other. You know, like there's still like New York still fucking hates Texas and vice versa. But now we're just technically not part of the United States. Well, and I mean, so it's
at that point, New York can't tell Texas what to do.
Yeah. But I mean, they really can't anyway, though. I mean,
yeah, though, that's the thing, though. So we're already doing this. People ask me this shit all the time. Like, is there going to be some kind of civil war? No, dude, it's going to be nullification. The same thing that kind of started the Civil War, but these days it wouldn't work out that way. So nullification has been going on since the beginning of this country. Nullification is essentially when a state tells the federal government to go fuck itself.
Yeah.
And California and Massachusetts have been doing that with weed since the early 2000s. They started way back in the day. This has been going on for 20 years now. They were like, look, this rule is stupid and we're not following it anymore.
Yeah.
And then enough people got on board. I mean, it's still federally illegal, but enough people are on board now where finally Obama's like, yeah, we're not doing weed anymore.
Yeah.
Right. So I think there's a lot more power in collectively saying no than just breaking up.
Agreed.
You know what I mean? Like you can do a lot of stuff like In-N-Out standing up and saying no. All those pilots, like Southwest tried to say, oh, it was weather issues. Oh, was it? Is that why people were walking around outside your building over here in Dallas the other day with protest signs? Fuck face.
Yeah. I mean, to me, so my just quick off the cuff take on all of that is that to me, those examples actually really highlight how much power the federal government actually doesn't have unless we just give it to them.
It's all imagined power.
Yeah.
Right? So it's like the federal government is Tinkerbell.
Yeah.
And if we stop believing that they have power, then they don't have it anymore.
Yeah. So I mean, to me, I'm not like so attached to the construct or prospect of, you know, the United States still being, you know, the 50 United States, but I just think, like, again, like, look at the upside. We're already at a point where if states just decide, you know what, go fuck yourself, they have in the past anyway.
Yeah. It's happened a number of times, it's worked out pretty well, to be honest.
I mean, I think the moral of the story is just fucking stand up.
You know? I mean, look, I agree with you. That's usually where this conversation goes for me, is like just saying a really resounding no from enough people is enough to shut a lot of shit down.
Yeah.
And we've seen it lately with a lot of the mandate stuff. It's in progress right now, but it is happening and it's having huge effects. And it's happened in the past before too. I mean, MLK and Medgar Evers and all these guys, they didn't fucking say, hey, you know what? America sucks. So we're just going to go, we're going to take all our people, our diaspora back to Africa and just live there. No, they fucking said no.
Yeah. We're not doing
it. I'm not going to the back of the bus, motherfucker.
Yeah.
Right. And enough people are like, you know what?
Yeah, fuck
I'm not
that.
Going to the back of the bus either.
Yeah.
And that's how it works. It's almost like the Hunger Games, I guess. You know what I mean? Enough people start saying no that the government just doesn't have any power anymore. It is literally like Tinkerbell.
Yeah. I mean, like I said, it's a fucking t-shirt. The government only has as much power as you let them have, you know, because they're not more powerful than fucking 330 million fucking people. I don't give a fuck what they have or what they do. It's a great conversation. Mm-hmm. I mean, I feel like you and I could talk for fucking 30 hours and not run out of shit to talk about, but I know we do.
Well, I have to go check and make sure Brittany hasn't
spent all your money.
All the money.
Yeah. You got to freeze the card on her while she's out. do you have anything you want to talk about or bring up?
You know, I think we've covered pretty much everything. I mean, what do you got going on lately?
So I just the book Unfuck America, that's coming out November 16th is when it's released. You can get it on
November 16th of this year.
Yeah.
Have you
yeah.
recorded the audio book and everything yet?
I haven't. So that's where I don't even know if it's too late to get in touch with.
That's an add-on you can do anytime.
Yeah. So for those of you listening, I am gonna. My plan is to do an audio book. It's just a matter of taking a few days to make it happen, but.
It's going to take you about 4 days. Probably.
Yeah. So it's
a pain in the ass.
Yeah. It's figuring out when I can have 4 days straight of nothing but doing that, which is a
well,
trick.
Technically you got the equipment to do it here well enough, to be honest, but it's a matter of having the producer on to be like, because if you sit there, how many pages is it? Like 130, 140 pages?
That's 180. I think.
180. Wow. That's a big one. So it's going to be like, you're going to mispronounce some shit.
Yeah. I don't mispronounce anything. I think that adds to the book, honestly. Like,
well, that's something that James Altucher does. He's a. I don't. Have you ever had him on? You should have him on. He's a very smart.
What's his
guy.
Name?
James Altucher, Altucher. His latest book is called Skip the Line, and I think Malcolm Gladwell is actually. We talked to him not too long ago. I think he's doing the same thing where he'll go in with his script and read his book, and a lot of times what happens, because we've done a couple of audio books with Ross. A lot of times what happens is you write a line and it sounds good, but when you say it out loud, it doesn't. So then you say it the way it should sound, and they will take what you actually said and go back and edit the book to match that.
That's really?
What Altucher's been doing, yeah.
Huh, that's cool.
But he leaves in, like, when he gets mad and swears and all kinds of other shit. Like, it makes it sound... I mean, the reason people love podcasts is because I don't want to say, hey, what do you think about X? And you say three lines. You give me your elevator pitch on X. Yeah. I want to hear you talk about it for 45 minutes and see what you really think. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I'm right there with you.
That's why people love that shit. Also, you got to do it in your own voice, too.
Yeah. No, I mean, the three books that I wrote prior to this are all in audiobook by somebody else. And everybody was like, I hated it because I was expecting to hear you and I didn't, you know. And so it's like, for this, my take is... Yeah, I think it makes sense to have a producer, but I don't need some motherfucker telling me how to read my own book.
No, for sure. You should do it exactly how you want to do it.
Yeah, like I'm going to read it verbatim, and, and how it comes out is how it fucking comes out. That's my take on it.
Yeah, no, that's the best way to do it, because it's what people... We were talking earlier about pattern seeking and stuff like that. The thing that human beings can recognize before... anything else is if you're full of shit.
Yeah.
Usually, right?
Yeah.
They can tell. People that pay attention can tell if you're full of shit or not.
Yeah. Yep. So that's the big thing that ramping up for that, and just the holidays with, you know, I launched Team Dog food and treats and all that earlier this year, and it's been going really well. And we're just, that takes up most of my time is that, the personal protection dogs, getting the book ready or getting ready for the book, I guess. Still doing the Warrior Dog Foundation nonprofit, and man, the podcast. So I do online training and have some other products as well. But so it's kind of a lot going on. But it's all the same shit that's been going on. The only thing new is the food and treats earlier this year, and then the book getting ready to come out. So how about you? You got anything in the pipe?
Yeah, I mean, Dakota and I are writing a book now, The American Party. We're going over all these principles, crowdsourcing, talking to people, and writing stuff, and doing interviews and such, and then. For Drinker Bros, I'm always making fun merch. Like, I've got one new shirt that says "Mandate This Dick," and the "I" in "Dick" is an actual dick.
Oh, that's awesome.
Let's see what else?
Is it veiny?
No, it's not veiny. It's all.
It's like cartoon.
It's black and white. Yeah, so you can't put veins in it. But what's the other one I made recently? The Grinch Who Stole Liberty or something, and it's Fauci and the Grinch.
That's awesome.
It's pretty funny. Yeah, I'd like to do a lot of stuff like that. We've got a hard seltzer coming out, too.
Oh, really?
8% hard seltzer.
Oh, shit.
Yeah.
So like a fucking heavy-duty IPA strength, huh?
Yeah.
What does it have a catchy fucking name?
It's called Hard AF.
Oh, that's cool.
Hard AF seltzer,
That's awesome. Like different flavors?
Yeah, we got a bunch, We'll come out with four at first, but we'll release another four after that.
That's awesome. Is Buffalo Fart going to be one of them?
Oh, I don't know if I can get my hands on that.
I know a guy. I'll help him. Yeah. It's a Buffalo Fart Sorcerer. That's good shit, man. Well, you and I have been meaning to do this for a while, and I can't thank you enough for taking time out of your schedule coming up here for it. It's been awesome having you on. I'd love to have you back regularly. I think it's such a good fit for this show and platform, and it's great getting to know you and having you on, so I appreciate you coming up.
Man, good to be here.
For those of you from the listening standpoint, again, I always appreciate your support, and in the comments, actually, specifically on YouTube, I would love any feedback from you guys in terms of shit you want to see. Not guests. We've asked that a million fucking times, and everybody says, oh, you should have so-and-so on. But you know, just anything different, fucking, you know, if you have some ideas, things that you want to see, I'm always open to feedback. I may tell every one of you to go fuck yourself and I'm not doing it, but I'm still open to at least hear it. So if, whether it's live streams or certain, you know, the way that a show goes or adding something to it or whatever, I'm all fucking ears. So, with that though, I do appreciate you guys tuning in week after week. It's because of you that, that this show exists and it wouldn't without you guys. So, from the bottom of my heart, I do appreciate you. And until next time, this is Mic Drop.